Record on this. Welcome to Magic Without Fears. I'm Frater RC, and today I'm talking to Jorge. Hello, Jorge.
Hello.
Am I world. Saying that right? I guess there's not really another way to say it, is there?
Yeah, you did. I'm surprised you got it. That's pretty good.
Yeah. Well, you know. Yeah, I'm not a Spanish speaker, but I try.
No, well, you got it. You got it. You got it, brother.
Well, let's this is our first time talking, though we've been going back and forth on the webs here and there in different places, sometimes a little punchy, trying to suss each other out as people do on Facebook and Instagram, all these nonsensical places of human gathering. And it's always best, I find, to try and really, you know, I was talking to an old occultist, a British guy, on a thing, and then I just, you know, I just took it to the DMs and asked him some questions, and he was shocked. He was like, wow, I thought most people of your generation just want to like take the piss out of me in the comments and then run away as soon as there's a real conversation. Like, my generation, man, how old do you think I am? Jesus, no. Like, you know, plus I was raised right. I like getting to know the real person and not just cause a firestorm in comment sections, though I've do that, I guess, occasionally here and there. So when did you first come aware of the podcast?
Oh, your podcast? Probably when I said about a year ago. Probably about a year ago. I don't know. It's like, it's kind of funny. It's like we all kind of know of each other, even though we don't know each other.
Yeah.
And eventually something that you know kind of shares something else, and you just happen to like get hooked on it, which is what happened with you for me. You know, we're like, I forgot who, I think Aaron shared something, and then I just like, oh, that's pretty cool. Just, you know, it was like, he has a Patreon to support this guy. I don't give you much, but you know,
definitely. I always forget you're even on the Patreon, which is cool. Thanks, folks. More people should join the Patreon. Yes, I'll you know, I
support the colors.
People can join it. They can support the podcast. It's great to support this thing. The podcast is mostly a labor of love, of course, because I think it's important to dialogue, and you know, I love the interview style podcast as well. But we already have so many of those that are really good. You know, the free speech banter, say what you want, say what thou wilt podcast didn't really seem to exist in the occult world. So I accidentally took on that mantle, I guess. But speaking of excellent interview podcasts, you asked me to listen to the, is it Laura?
Yeah, Laura Davila, yeah.
Yeah, on glitch bottles. So I did that today, and you said as a way we could maybe find that as a jumping off point to our mutual interests.
Oh, brother, we have so many. It's like, I don't know where you want me to start. The reason why I asked you to listen to that one is because I agreed a lot of her points, but I kind of not disagree, but I think that it should be better explained.
It could have been longer, but I always feel that way about glitch bottle, of course. Yeah.
For sure. And there were some glitch bottles were like twice than the length of hers. And, you know, and then the thing is that she's like, people up in the north, they were kind of left without a lot of education. And then we just went rogue. And look, with like she did, it's like, you know, what do you call it? Like a Santería de Rancho or something like that. Something of the
Brujeria de Rancho.
Brujeria de Rancho, yeah, there you go.
And so what's that mean for us non-Spanish speakers? I'm guessing witchcraft of the farm?
Of the ranch.
Well, I was trying to be clever.
No, but I think, and also it's like, she's obviously still kind of like trying to kind of like settle herself within the English language and within the American culture. And so the El Rancho, it basically means kind of middle of nowhere. They're kind of like a province. They're not really quite city people. And so in a way, it's kind of a derogatory term for some people, but she kind of owns it, which is awesome. And she owns it, and also her the way she practices her witchcraft is also, she owns it, you know. It's like she was saying, it's like by whatever means necessary, with very little things, and we're gonna make it happen. And that's admirable for sure.
I really loved the interview. I thought she was great. I think, you know, obviously, for those who don't know some of my views, I agree with her fully about the idea of gatekeeping and closed traditions. I think it's nonsensical for the most part, with some caveats, with some footnotes, probably a lot of footnotes on that subject, to be honest. But yeah. If people want to know more, listen to the Glitch Bottle episode with her. But the idea, like she points out, something that's very real for me as a child of immigrants, right, or third generation. My parents were, you know, she talks about how she would hate for her kids or grandkids to grow up and just because they were born in America, be then cut off from the tradition that she in many ways used to bring them there. Well, she accredits Santa Muerte with getting her to America, but for the rest of it, she focuses on the other brujeria aspects of her practice, and she doesn't want her kids and grandkids and great grandkids to feel cut off from that. And pointed out that, you know, it's how you're raised very much, right? And that's something I'm very sensitive to as the, you know, in my family mostly left Ireland. And, you know, Irish people do not take kindly to the Irish diaspora. If you're Irish but born outside of Ireland, they can be very, very nasty. Not all of them. Most of them are awesome. But you'll find a lot of nastiness. Like when you go back there, if you're often advised, when you go visit Ireland, don't let them know your family comes from there. Don't let people know that. If you're getting in a conversation with someone and you're sitting down and you're actually talking, then it's fine. But don't generally let people know that, because someone might just be like, hey, I'm going to fuck this person up just because they're a blow-in now, or they're coming to like revel in the culture that we suffered to preserve. And I encountered a ton of that in my years there. So I'm very, I'm sympathetic to what she's saying. The culture is not based on where you're born or what your names are, or even who your parents are. I think she's talking about raising her kid Mexican, but her kid is half white and half Asian, half Chinese.
Yeah.
But her kid's fully Mexican because she is her mother and she raised her. I was like, that's beautiful. It's nice to hear some common sense on this topic. You know what I mean?
Right, right. Yeah. I'm part Chinese, even though like both of my parents and my grandparents that were born in Mexico City. But, you know, one of my great-grandmothers, she was from China. She
That's awesome.
To work on the railroad. So, like, there are some Chinese Mexican. I'm also part Irish. I didn't even know. It came into ancestry.com. And then it's like, you're like 2-3% Irish. I was like, what the freak? And then I learned about the San Patricios up in Chihuahua, where they fought during the Mexican War, during the Mexican Revolutionary War. And then I was like, oh, that kind of makes sense. But
who were they? The San Patricios.
I have no idea how they ended up there, but there were Irish and some Welsh and I think some Scottish people that ended up in kind of by the border of Mexico, kind of where the Alamo is. And they were there working. I don't know what they were doing. I don't know the story very well. Some people know it way better than I do. But the Mexican Revolutionary War broke out, and the Americans, instead of being like real pricks, and the Irish people, like you said, kind of like gangs in New York, it's like some people are divided and some people are like settled. And so the Irish and Welsh people had to like choose sides. It's like either you're going to fight on the side of the Mexicans or you're going to fight on the side of the Americans, but you have to choose a side because you cannot just stand by. And they chose the side of the Mexicans. And so they fought and they beat the Americans in the Alamo. And then Santana kind of like went haywire, and then, you know, Mexico lost. The point of the story is that the Irish somehow mixed with the Mexicans, and you know, here I am with 3% Irish blood.
it's not a bad mix. Like, you know, in my, you know, my Irish family's part of the Black Irish, which is just Irish that mixed with Spanish sailors. So the Spanish Hispanic blood in the Irish seems to be a, you know, not a bad combination. It's just even more dramatic and fiery, passionate. Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, we have strong feelings about things.
I didn't even know. I thought it was like, in fact, there was a professor of mine that he used to tell me, he's like, where are you from? I was like, well, I'm from Mexico. And it's like, I came here to the United States when I was 5 years old. But I told him, he's like, I was born in Mexico. He's like, you're not Mexican. And it's like, what do you mean? He's like, I remember Mexico. He's like, I know where I was born. And then he's like, yeah, but you're not Mexican. He's like, what does that mean? It's like, you're something else. It's like, you have green eyes and, you know, you think differently. And, you know, somebody really educated you since a very early age in a strange way, which is not Mexican. And then, you know, it's like he kind of hit the nail on the head, because mostly I'm like 45% like a Sephardic Jew. And then
you are.
Yeah, 45% Sephardic Jew from my mother's side and from my dad's side. And then a lot of Mexican, some Irish, a little bit of Black, a little bit Chinese, a little bit of everything, even though I'm Mexican. Yeah.
But where were you born?
I was born in Mexico City.
Okay. And you live where now?
I live now in Utah.
Right. Because we've discussed Mormonism before on the interwebs.
Yes, sir.
Yeah. And were you raised Mormon?
Nope.
No.
No, it was kind of a weird thing. I guess we can get into this part of the conversation.
So we can go. Actually, I'd like to first note, maybe we could stick with the glitch bottle. Again, her name's
Laura Davila.
Laura. Yeah. What else did you like about her episode? And what she said about the tradition, which I assume you're familiar with.
I am, but for me, it was different. I mean, my tradition was more Sephardic. I mean, she touches up on the Sephardic kind of like brujos, kind of like witchcraft, because it's kind of interesting. It's like, I don't know how much you want to hear about the history of the Sephardic Jews. The Sephardic Jews were pretty witchy, even when they got here. And there are a lot of chronicles from Fries, for example, that settled here in, they settled in Mexico. And a lot of them were conversos. So there were Sephardic Jews that converted into Catholicism. And that was the only way that we could survive. You cannot just come into Mexico, being New Spain, and say, I am a Sephardic Jew. If you did that, you're dead. So you had to somehow convert and keep it in the download. But some people knew about it, but they tried to suppress it, or they kept, like my family, travel all around and tried to keep it somehow alive in different ways, but never settled in one place. And no one quite figures out what the heck you're doing. So they don't have enough time for them to figure out how to kill you. And so the thing that I liked about her, it was like, by whatever means necessary. But for us, witchcraft was a lot more elaborate. Like, she touches a little, she kind of hints to the Book of San Cipriano, on like making the inks and making the tools and making the paper. Well, when you're a fray or you're a priest, you do have the time to do that. You know, you do have the time to make your own ink, and sometimes you don't have access to buying inks, and sometimes you have to make your own. And so, obviously, I think the Book of San Cipriano was not one book. It was probably three books that were compiled together. Because sometimes it gets very Kabbalistic. Sometimes it gets kind of like native witchcraft. And sometimes it just gets kind of like all propaganda. This is of the devil, Lucifer, and all this weird stuff. So it seems like whoever wrote it was compiled from three different, in my opinion, from three different traditions. And so I have family that, you know, were priests. In fact, I have an uncle who is a Jesuit priest. He's still a priest up in like middle nowhere Mexico, where the cartels are. And so I definitely sympathize with the things she talks about. But, you know, we were kind of more in the cushy end of the spectrum, so we were able to practice and study a lot more. Whereas them is, whereas the way she put it, it's like, you know, just do it. Yeah.
Was there much of any transmission that you're aware of from magical or Kabbalistic teachings from the Sephardic folks into Mexico and different magical traditions there?
Oh yeah, for sure. You totally see it. I mean, when for example, Alexander was comparing how certain Salomonic entities compare to some Brujeria entities, and it's like, oh, they're very similar. It's because they come from the same source. You know, like you have the Book of San Cipriano, which talks about the same thing. The Icirigirons, the Book of Carlomagno. You know, you have books that are obviously derived from Salomonic books. I mean, the difference is that they had to transform the, for example, Saint Michael became a certain saint, or saints. Gabriel, Angel Gabriel, had to transform himself into other saints. And, you know, therefore, for you to be able to conduct your magic, you ask or you make petitions to the saints, or you try to get familiars through the use of saints, but they're not really saints. They're just attributions of a particular planetary correspondence. Like, for example, the thing she was talking about, one specific saint that equates to Mars. It's like, you know, kind of Copeland Donnelly, Shigeru Samael. But Samael transformed into some whatever saint, you know, that they use. And of course, everybody is like doing their own thing. So the saint is going to take on different identities or different things. It's like, I don't know if you've been to Spain or you've been to Mexico, there are like patron saints, churches in every town. And that is very Sephardic, where, you know, you have a particular town dedicated to a particular entity or sovereignty. And it doesn't really need to have one single name. It can just be whatever name, as long as you're able to attribute the characteristics of that particular entity into the church or saint or angel or whatever you want to call it. So yeah, it's like, you know, what she says, like, it does make sense, but I'm able to perceive more beyond that because I'm able to know a little bit more of the history behind all of this stuff.
Yeah, very, very, very cool. Yeah, I know. I haven't really spent time in Mexico, not since I was two. Apparently, you know, I was there when I was two. I've been to. Have I been to Spain? Sort of. I've been to Mallorca.
Sort of. Yeah.
But everyone there speaks German.
Right on. No, I've been through a lot.
I had some good times in Mallorca when I was in Zelator in 97. And it was cool. I was staying in this villa outside of Palma. And it's great. It's such a magical city, especially because of, you know, the Blessed Ramon Llull has his statue there. And, you know, very much dedicated to the work he did for, it was pretty humanitarian for his time, I think. You know, he still had his views. But yeah, hail bop was in the sky. So when I had my own veranda in the villa, and hail bop, remember the comet?
Okay.
Right. Yeah, you remember the big comet that was just lighting up the sky? It was amazing. Every night during the ritual work on my veranda, like three decks up, looking up hail bop. It was a beautiful time. I really enjoyed seeing that little bit of Spain, but yeah,
hopefully. That's beautiful. The food there is amazing. The pastries they make there, the ensaimadas, man, they're like so awesome.
Oh, yeah.
I've been trying to replicate them for years. I've never been able to.
Oh wow.
Yeah, they make great food in Mallorca for sure.
That's cool that you've I don't recall. I just don't recall. It was a long time ago. Yes, but so are you Mormon, or were you Mormon? Were you?
I am Mormon. Yeah, I am Mormon.
And when did that happen?
I don't know if you want to hear the story. I'm going to tell a little bit about myself. When I was around 5 or 6, I used to bug my dad a lot because he used to make talismans and used to do like magic, but kind of on the lowdown. And I used to ask him about a lot of questions, just like that. You know, it's like, what metal are you using? Does the matter? Does the metal matter? What does the symbol mean? What does the name mean? And so I used to ask him a bunch of questions, and he answered me, but there were some times where he told me, he's like, where I swear an oath not to tell this. So he was in like some magical Frenchy Masonic organizations in Mexico. And so there was a time in which like he just kind of got aggravated at me. And he used to take me walking like kind of like a forest south of Mexico City. And he used to walk for hours. And I don't know why he did that. I mean, I later I got it, but we used to walk for hours. He used to walk ahead of me. And then one time he turned around and he saw me staring at a gigantic rock. And then he looked at me and he said, what did it say? I was like, what the heck? He's like, what are you talking about? And then my dad is like, I know the rock talked to you. What did it say? And then it's like, how do you know he talked to me? It's like, because I know. And then I told him, he's like, well, he told me that he was sad. And then I was like, okay. I'm gonna walk ahead for about 30 minutes. I will come back and you tell me more about the conversation, okay? And I was like, rocks don't talk, Dad. Like, are you freaking insane? But you know, I paid attention to him. So I sat next to the rock and he told me a story. He told me that the reason why he was sad, it was because it missed the river, that there was an earthquake. Mexico City was always or has always had earthquakes, and there was an earthquake, and he used to sit by the riverbed, up the hill, and then but because of the earthquake, the rock fell. So I was 5 and 6. I had no idea if the story was true or not. But then my dad came back and he said, do you notice the shape of that rock? And it's like, is it round? It's like, how do you think rocks get round? And it's like, because of water, the rocks get round. So you may think that the rock did not talk to you, but you knew stuff about the rock that you did not know. And I will show you something else. And then he showed me, he analyzed the rock and he said, it's like, this is the mark where it used to be the river. And this is the mark that was in the air. And then I was shocked because my dad kind of proved that I was talking to a rock. And then after that experience, I started having dreams of that forest. I'm having goosebumps. And where I saw a spirit, where it was basically like a hand, and I was terrified of it. And then eventually I got used to the hand. And then the hand kind of guided me throughout my life. So I did not know it at that time, but my dad basically introduced me to him, to my first familiar. And I was 6 years old. In fact, Miss Davila calls them spirits. I don't know what you want to call them. They have many different names. In Nahuatl, for example, the Aztec language, they call them Nahual. In the Sephardic Jewish tradition, sometimes they call it Dende. And so the familiars have many different names. And so I had my first Dende. And as a result, throughout my whole life, I have had premonitions, advice of multiple things I needed to do. And in one of them, I used to live in Hollywood, and that's kind of like where I spent most of my adolescent, young adult life. And I used to go to engineering school full time. I used to work full time, and I had a heavy rock band on the side.
Oh, awesome.
And we used to tour Sunset Strip and play gigs here and there all over LA, tour a couple of times. And I was exhausted. One time I just got down on my knees and I asked, it's like, God, it's like, you need to help me out because I'm exhausted. You know, it's like, I cannot continue like that. And I did that and I went to Mexico, tried to go to the Catholic Church. I hated it. I used to live very close to the Scientology building, the blue one. Man, I hated those guys with a with a passion. And I tried many different things. I had a friend who later became a girlfriend who did the Hare Krishna thing. I didn't like that either. Until eventually, out of desperation, I guess my familiar kind of felt sorry for me and said, walk. And I was working a morning shift for, I used to be an event coordinator for like media events. So I was doing one for Nickelodeon. And I had to be there like at 4 a.m. I finished the whole event with a bunch of screaming kids around 1 p.m. I just wanted to go to bed. And I just like was about to put the key, my key into the building, into the lock of the building, and the voice said, walk. I was like, I don't usually hear voices. It's kind of weird. I'm just going to go to bed because I'm super exhausted. And so I walked into the lobby and the voice sternly said, walk. I was like, oh crap, you're not going to shut up, are you? And it was like, walk. So I turned around, got outside of my building, and it said, left. All right. So I made a left. Long story short, I walked for about an hour. I ended up right in the corner of USC, kind of like the northwest corner of USC. And I stopped hearing the voice for like about 30 minutes. And then Minnesota's like, man, this is such a waste of time. I just walked like an hour and I was super exhausted. I was just going to cross the street and take the bus back home. And then the voice said, turn around. So I turned around and there was a gigantic stone that said in Spanish, Church of Jesus Christ of Latter-day Saints. And of course, being the rebel guy that I was like, you know, forget this. I'm not going to pay attention to that. That is such a young church. Like, what are you, like, who cares? So that night, I was kind of dating, kind of seeing this girl who was like a, kind of like a Mormon, but not really Mormon. And so she told me, it's like, you cannot disregard this prompting. It's like, people pray for these promptings and you just like completely disregard it. Like, it's nothing. It's like, you cannot do that. And it's like, I'm going to take you to the, was at LA Visitor Center and show you something. And then so I showed up. Then I learned that Joseph Smith was a Freemason and Brigham Young was a Freemason and William Woodrow was a Freemason. I was like, okay, I can jive with this. And then they showed me kind of like how the quorums were formed. I was like, man, this religion is so Masonic and this is what I've been looking for. Because I was really heavy deep into the GD. And I was really heavy into my Masonic Lodge because we used to meet in our Masonic Lodge. And so I thought, I was like, okay, I'll jive with this. And so I joined. It's kind of funny. It's like I walked in. It's like, hey, I want to become a member. It's like, I don't know. You don't understand. It's like, you need to listen to the missionaries. And I was like, okay, I'll put up with this. And so you have to like 18, 19-year-old girls trying to tell me about scripture. And I told him, it's like, that's not how it is. It's like, this is what the Bible says. It's like, oh, well, how do you know? Because I read the freaking Bible like three times and, you know, from front to back. It was like, you know, I know it pretty well. And so they used to call me for like biblical advice, you know, when they had their investigations. And that's how I became a Mormon, just like, just following my petition from my familiar. That's how I became a Mormon. Or I guess in Mormonism, we call it the spirit.
Yeah. I mean, that's how Cat Stevens became Yusuf Islam, isn't it?
What was that?
Cat Stevens had the same thing. He was literally called, a voice directed him through the city. And next thing he knew, he was standing outside of a mosque. And so Cat Stevens went in and was like, he didn't know why he was there, but so this voice brought him there, and that he had a revelation and converted to Islam and became Yusuf Islam, and the rest is history.
All right,
I love a great voice. I've listened to his albums. I think his Other Cup was the first album he put out as Yusuf Islam when he came out of musical retirement, because he gave up playing music for like 20 years, something like that. Yeah, and it came out when I was living in Belfast. So I was listening to it as I'd walk around that dangerous town or dangerous parts of that town. And it was beautiful. I was like, this is great. Everyone's bitching about the fact that he became Muslim or changed his name or whatever, which, dear Lord, you know, let people do whatever religion they want, right? You know, especially if they're following the positive version of the religion and not the more afflicted, interpretations that arise within every faith usually, right? Most people aren't extremists, much less violent ones. So it's like, leave the guy alone, man. Let him do his thing.
Yeah, I don't know why people attack religion so bad. It's like, you know, everybody makes out of themselves whatever they make out of themselves, whatever, regardless of what label you put on yourself. You know, there are like some really great Mormons, there are some really bad Mormons, there are some really great pagans, there are some really bad pagans. A really good friend of mine, he's a chaos magician, and he has been like that for many years. And even though I'm a Mormon, he still puts up with me, and sometimes we talk about crazy things, and we have known each other before, you know, for many, many, many years. I have friends that are OTO, chaos, GD. I have met all the quorum of the 12 apostles and a couple of prophets of the Mormon church. You know, so I've hung out with everyone.
So you're a Mason.
Yeah, I guess you can say that, yeah.
You've been through the Blue Lodge or whatever. Are you still practicing and part of a lodge, or has that given way to Mormonism?
No. I used to love my lodge in California, but then Utah is such a weird, weird place. Like, seriously, I have never been able to find a lodge here in Utah that I liked. And I have really, really tried for years. In fact, I tried recently. I was working up in Virginia, and I wanted to have a current dues card because I wanted to go to the Fredericksburg, Virginia lodge. Because somebody posted on Facebook, friends of friends, how the altar still of George Washington still sits there. A Bible where Marquis de Lafayette, you know, signed, and also George Washington probably touched it, or it's signed by him. And so I really wanted to go to the Fredericksburg, Virginia Lodge. And so I paid my dues up in California, and I went to the Fredericksburg, Virginia Lodge, and it was amazing. I got to participate in a third degree. It was great. And so, but then I come back to Utah, and I was like, oh, crap. You know, it's like, I wanted to join, and all they talk about it is like nonsense, kind of like chicken and beef. There's no essence. And I've looked. And probably about 15 years ago, 10 or 15 years ago, I hooked up with a couple of Freemasons that actually did like the esoteric part of Freemasonry. But for some reason or another, they just didn't like me, or I don't know. So they just blocked me on Facebook and didn't talking ass about me. But I'm cool, man. It's like, I don't care. You know, and then they wanted to start a G Lodge here, and I really didn't have the energy or the mental capacity to like be a one know it all hierophant. And so I just, it never happened. Because, you know, I got my 5-6 up there in the Monestra temple, so I'm able to open up something here. But
the which know, temple?
The Monestra, Cursed Monestra temple.
All right, so you're with Chris. Yeah, cool, awesome.
Yeah, I was with Chris for like about 4 or 5 years.
Did you ever meet Damian Murphy?
Name sounds familiar, but I cannot think.
Yeah, I believe he learned with Chris Monestra. Maybe it was also a bit of Laura Jennings. Anyway, anyway, that's cool. Yeah, Chris Monestra. What was she like working with for you?
She
was, I never met her. I never met her, but I, you know.
I don't know. You can have many different opinions about Chris. Some people think very highly of her. Some people don't.
For those who don't know, she was Israel Regardi's partner.
Yeah. I helped her move her bed once, so I saw where the action happened.
You touched the bed.
Touched the bed where the action happened, I guess. But I learned a lot from her. I don't regret the time that I was under her. It was awesome.
Yeah.
She certainly taught us a lot. And sometimes he was Some people thought there was she was a little too much, that that she asked a lot from people, that she should have taught more, that she should have been more lenient. But I worked a lot in that temple, and I enjoyed it, and I treasure those experiences. I don't regret a single minute that I was not there, that I was there.
Yeah, I feel the same way about my experience. It's so easy, given that the sort of wonderful variety that there actually exists even within the Golden Dawn tradition now. I think it's not a bad thing that there's variety.
I mean, you were with Sink, right?
Yes, my estranged godfather. yeah. Well, so
horror stories about that. I was just like, oh my gosh, did that really happen?
I think things changed years later, or well, maybe not. There's this, we can't get into it now there was very well, first of all, he was not as big a part of things as people real think, right? Because you know, he was most of the time living on his own outside and disconnected from all the temples, and you know, he did keep trying to step down, but kept getting called back to sort of take charge because no one else really wanted to do it. I mean, even one of the interesting stories of Mathers and Westcott is when it came time to reconsecrate, I think it was on the second time they had to reconsecrate the vault and, you know, take the oath on the cross. Neither of them wanted to do it. I think that at some point they had both done it, or maybe only one of them had, but neither of them wanted to. So people have a very big misunderstanding about what leadership in magical temples or organizations looks like. And especially in the Golden Dawn, the titles like honored or very honored or greatly honored, those are not titles of really of adoration. Those are titles of, those are yokes of labor.
Yeah.
Like, for sure. It means when everyone else goes home, you got 5 hours of more shit to do. It means before everyone gets there, you're up before dawn. You know, that's what that means. And so what do you get for that? People calling very honored. So
nothing.
there was a lot of days I would have rather had a few more hours sleep than have people call me very honored Frater RC. You know what I mean? It's like, the reason people end up in those roles of leadership is literally because no one else will do it.
Yeah.
Right? Or is willing to do it. A lot of people want titles for some fucking reason. I still can't figure out because you know, honors without accomplishment are beyond meaningless. They're detrimental to you, every aspect of your mental health, your soul, and your body, right? So I hope that changes at some point, because people are a bit fixated on that stuff.
Well, actually, up here, there have been a couple of people that have wanted me to start something, and then it starts and it kind of dies off because I'm not very passionate about trying to be the Hierophant, like you said. You know, it's like you swear oaths on the 5 equals 6, and you know, you kind of like want to live up to them. But at the same time, it's like, how much of your heart are you really going to put in there, even though you swore an oath, you know, to try to perpetuate the tradition? And so it's hard to maintain it, but it was certainly a very interesting social experiment on how the religions get formed and why do they get formed and why do people get so embezzled into charlatans as opposed to like real esoteric teachers. And so, you know, it's like people like the show, people like the attention, and people like the empty promises. And of course, if they're empty and they like the show, there's no real meat behind it. And so that is why I found that it's like, oh, this is why people fall into like cults and, you know, personalities like those evangelists and, you know, people who have more of a show than real through meaning or purpose behind their work or their lessons or their knowledge. And so that is something I learned from those experiences. You know, it's like, I'm just gonna give you, you know, the meat. I am not gonna give you a show. I am. I don't have to like wear a cape for me to like show you the who the heck I'm supposed to be or who do you think I am. And you know, it's like, I'm just gonna show you the meat and show you the door. If you want to step through it, awesome. If not, you know, it's up to you. It's like, well, you don't really quite give me what I need, so bye. It's like, all right, have a good life. Thank you very much for leaving me alone.
Yeah. I always, after I left Zinc and them, or after I closed the temple. I mean, we were our own temple very much, right? So like, you know, you didn't even meet Zinc if you in the Outer Order. Of course not. You wouldn't even meet him. Maybe you'd see him here once or twice, depending on how many events you went to internationally. But yeah, you had no idea of who they were. And also like the leadership of the Inner Order is kept quiet. So we didn't know who was really running things or in charge. You just had a group of a bunch of adepts who were all generally really awesome people. And our temple in Vancouver was started by Frater Ka, Nineveh Shadrach. And so he started that. He was, of course, you know, came up from LA back to Canada and started that temple, and then, you know, trained some adepts. Those adepts trained people like me and Martin Thibault. And then we trained out. Martin went off to Montreal to do his thing, and I stayed at Vancouver and trained people there. And then the adept above me left, so I was the guy running it. And then eventually it came time to close it, and well, the fire department let us know the illegal construction had hit. We knew it was inevitable. The construction we did of this in this 3,000 square foot loft was incredible. Like, we just had the best place. I and like we were saying, this goes back to what you're saying, like, no matter how many varieties there are, and maybe some orders are better at this or better at that, I would never trade my experience for any of them. I wouldn't trade my experience to go to, you know, even to go back in time to the original order. I wouldn't, not a chance. Partly is because I really like what some of the modern orders have done with taking the teachings seriously, taking the spirits seriously about developing things magically in line with the historical tradition that we have and that comes out of the grimoires. Because that's very much what Golden Dawn teaching is preparation for working with grimoires. A lot of people think that grimoires and Golden Dawn have nothing to do with each other, and they're completely separate systems, and Golden Dawn magicians never work with grimoires, which is just, I think people are just saying that because they're trying to be polemical. I think they're trying to like cause fights, or they're trying to just shit on others to make themselves seem better. Right? Like, oh, no one else knows the good stuff except for us. But just, it's so silly given all the grimoires that Mather's translated. And the fact that he couldn't just start up a school. Mathers and Westcott couldn't start up just a Rosicrucian magic school and right away be like, okay, we're going to teach you how to work with Almadel, Key of Solomon, and the Goetia. You couldn't just take a bunch of Victorian upper middle class folks and start teaching them that stuff out of the blue, right? There had to be preparatory work, and that's where they did such an amazing job taking all these. It was sort of like the icing on the cake of Renaissance syncretism, is how I see it.
Yeah, I totally agree with you. Yeah, it's like, you know, why did he translate it if he wasn't going to use it? Yeah, for sure.
No. Yeah. Plus, like, if you do the work seriously and the initiations are being done seriously with all the tools and all that stuff, and just if it's just being done well, then the spirits show up. The gods, the forces, the energies, the names and images, all that stuff. They come alive, and they do come alive in your sphere, and they put you through it, no matter. You know, even if you were at the startup temple that you just made with your friends. And MacGyvered the whole thing because there's no other options nearby, and you do that hard enough, you do serious enough, the forces will show up and put you through it.
Oh, I testify to that for sure.
Yeah,
it's like,
that is the consensus in the Golden Dawn tradition for people who might be wondering or thinking that there's still some lineage war or something. There never was, and that's never been a serious thing.
I agree. Yeah, for me, like solitary work, it works sometimes. Sometimes it doesn't. It depends on what I do. But for sure, I think when I really started to get the GD from the Great Observator, things started to happen. and they were never as strong as when I was invested in the work. Well, once I came back from my slaughter initiation, and I had one of like the most lucid dreams that I ever had, and you know, I was kind of like somewhere where so an initiation happened in a language that I didn't understand, and I was sitting in some ancient temple and gates opened and I was there, bro. You know, it's like I was peeing in my pants trying to grab a little notebook to write things with, but I was there and alone. That has never happened. I have tried, but it has never happened. The GD work definitely does open things that you cannot open on your own. Like, I mean, at least for me.
Well, yeah, even, I mean, just the fact that the initiations are sort of have all this fuel from the Enochian system that's there in the elemental grades. And I guess they're still there in the 5-6, but I guess you could debate to what extent. And you could debate to what extent the neophyte, but in the elemental grades is such a huge part. And that's just also one of the smallest parts with all the other god forms and invocations and spirits that are active within the temple. It's like, it's so much, not to mention the geometry and the movements. And it's of course, so much is going on. It's really hard to conceive of. Yeah. I think that's what's wonderful about it, is this, and you couldn't have done that. Well, you couldn't really create something like that and have it be effective without the guidance of spirit and spirits, like, you know, the angels that transmitted, like it's Raphael. I think in a lot of the cases, a lot of the stuff in the Golden Dawn was transmitted by Raphael, just like in the Enochian system. Then probably in most grimoires, a lot of the stuff comes from some of the main archangels. What, do you have any grimoires that are favorites of yours?
There was a point in which I just stopped reading grimoires. I just kind of went on my own, started writing my own stuff. you know, I started with the Book of San Cyprian, a little bit with Black Magic and my rebel teenage years. And so, but fortunately, my familiar was always there to bail me out of my emptiness. And my familiar led me to many different teachers and many different places, which was kind of amazing. I met, for example, I studied for a couple of years under Stephen Holler. Stephen Holler was the one that introduced me to Chris Monestra. And so kind of like people that knew regarding person.
Just okay, what years are we talking here in LA? Was this going
on? I graduated, I think, in 1997 from high school. And my high school used to be like 4 or 3 blocks away from Philosophical Research Society.
Oh, so cool.
Yeah. And so I used to walk up the street to Los Feliz Boulevard, and I used to watch it. I used to see it all the time. And I used to like stare at the statues and read the stuff that was in the statues. And I used to read sometimes the schedules. It's like, yeah, we're here on Saturdays. It's like, all right, cool. Stephen Holler's free. I am broke. I got a date with myself and Stephen Holler to just listen to him talk. And so he just talked about Carl Jung like pretty much twice a month, I think. So I got to learn a lot about Carl Jung and about the Theosophist and about the Golden Dawn, you name it. Stephen Holler is like, even at that time, he was a library of knowledge. You know, it was like, he just outpours knowledge to no end. And I was just there like a little rock on the corner, just absorbing it, you know, sometimes pitching in, you know, for like his donation that he put up. But he was always kind enough to just teach for free, which was awesome. And so fortunately, I have, you know, always kind of like followed whatever my familiar says, and I just bump into cool stuff. I don't know why here in Utah there's no cool stuff. I'm sticking up, but it's cool, you know. I grew to like it. I don't complain that much. In fact, the terrain here really lends itself well for the work that I've been doing. Since I left LA, you know, like the fact that we have rivers close by, you have paths where you can like walk forever, you can bike for miles and miles and miles and start talking to yourself. And there's where little is here, it's pretty cool.
I thought it was beautiful. I got to spend just half a day in Salt Lake City on a business trip to Vegas for a convention. So I was there with the co-workers, and my sister was there. We hired her to be our what is affectionately termed in the industry sometimes a booth bitch.
I don't know what that is.
You know, the girl who stands at the booth while you're off dealing with distributors and stuff like that. It's nice to have a girl there to draw people in. To talk.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. She would be very proud of me for not pinching from that term. She's a tough cookie. But yeah, so we got to spend, and it was beautiful. Then the landscape around Salt Lake City, and yeah, it was cool little the little shopping area built for the Olympics, you know. we got some of that from our. We had to build that for our Olympics too. It's just it was cool. It was I liked the city. What I saw of it, yeah. And the mountains and the hills and all that, it's very familiar to me being from Vancouver, of course. It's nice to have all that. And LA is just such a whole other world. So were you, what years were you initiating the Golden Dawn? Because I was in LA basically around the same time that you're talking. And we were both sort of teenagers, just a couple years, about 2 years apart.
I think in 1999.
Yeah. Cool.
1999, 2000. That's when, like, Chris Monastro finally told me, fine, you're not that crazy. We'll take you in.
That's awesome.
Yeah, but she had a PhD in psychology or something. So she picked your brain pretty good. And so, and they also, from my understanding, they like, she used to grab us and speak for like an hour or two and talk about previous experiences at the temple, what are the minutes of the temple for particular dates, who was kicked out, who are we bringing in, who is going to get investigated, and so on and so forth. And so I got to learn a lot from her and from the drama and all the cool stuff that was happening before I came in. David Griffin, Michael Craig. So a lot of cool stuff that I learned from like the years that I was not there. Yeah.
Did Griffin learn from her?
Yeah, for sure. But I think Griffin, he definitely had an agenda even before he came into the temple. He had an agenda. He knew exactly what he wanted, and then Monastra kind of gave it to him, and everybody got pissed and took off because nobody really liked him. He was just kind of like, my understanding is he was like an egomaniac. He had an agenda, and he just. Nobody wanted to put up with him, so a lot of people just took off. But then he just took off, and then so Monastra kind of was left there and still to carry the reins, and she carried along people like me, you know, and many other people that are still doing it to this day. People that are still, you know, carrying on her legacy in her temple and other temples that are in the surrounding area. So props to them, you know, that's great.
Yeah. Yeah, and Don. So Don was trained with her as well. Don did a lot of teaching, of course, in our order, and was sort of a honorary adept because of his, yeah, frequent teachings in the early days of our order. I never got to meet him, but I was called to do work for him when he was dying from cancer. So I was honored to play that role in his life, I guess, to get to be part of a group ritual work for him when he was in his transitioning out of this life. So yeah.
You live in Texas?
Huh?
You lived in Texas then, right?
I don't know. Yeah.
I mean, you lived in Texas.
Me, no. Never. I've never been there. No.
Oh, okay.
No, I would just fly down to LA or drive down. I drove like from 97 to 2003. I drove from Vancouver to LA well over 30 times. Half of those by myself, so you know, and lots of flights just to go to participate at the Temple of Isis down there. Yeah, go to Bodhi Tree bookstores. Our order had a bookstore for quite a long time. I don't remember what it was called though. Yeah, long time ago, high school.
Yeah, I remember the Bodhi Tree. Yeah, it was cool.
Bodhi Tree was great. Yeah.
That's where all the weirdos congregated.
We were there once. Kramer was there from Frasier, and or not from Frasier, from Seinfeld and asked one of the guy, one of our guys, if he could teach him black magic.
He joined a lodge.
Only in LA.
he joined a lodge. He was initiated, I want to say 3 months or 4 months before I did into Freemasonry.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, so he was in a lodge for a while. Yeah.
What's the actor's real name?
Michael Richards.
Okay. I never got into Seinfeld. It wasn't my thing. I could never figure out what it was about. And now, as an adult, I'm told it was about nothing. And that's the point. I missed that as a kid, I guess. I don't know. I wasn't a TV watcher at all, that's for sure, back then. So that's very cool. Yeah, there's a lot of, I mean, LA is sort of, it's one of the things I keep wrestling with. Tell me what you think, because this relates to you being in Salt Lake City now. The issue is, it really, the best place to have a magical group is away from like major cities, or ideally away from any city, but definitely away from major cities. The problem is, the only place you really can have a magical group is in a city, and moreover, really a major city, because there's just such a small minority of the population that's just at all interested in this, let alone cut out for it.
Well, I don't know. I've seen a lot of orders. Some of them that have disintegrated, some of them that are still there. I think, like you said, it's like a group is the group. It doesn't matter where it's formed. You know, it's like that terrain is just almost completely irrelevant of the landscape. But I think that the group is the group. It's like the people that form the order are the order. I mean, it's like it boils down to like nothing else, really.
Yeah.
It's kind of, if you want to make it happen, you make it happen anywhere, you know, like middle of the desert, Ghana, if you have the people to want to do it, you know. But you know, here in Salt Lake, the people are not there, you know. They have their own stigmas, they have their own problems, they have their own bickering. I can't even tell you about like Masonic conversations that I got into here, like some of the deepest like conversations that I got with Freemasons was about bickering about old books in the Salt Lake Masonic temple. I was like, what the freak are you talking about? And we just went on for hours, or about the cool things that they did in the Air Force, or the cool things that they did when they were working for some company up in the mountain. It's like, there is no essence. There's no effort to try to understand what is in the degree. They memorize a degree, but they have absolutely no idea what it means or what it's trying to teach, in my opinion. I mean, I may be mistaken, and this is not overgeneralizing. I'm pretty sure there are some people that do, but I have never met them, and I have tried really hard to find them. It's like, even I told them, it's like, and I was like, hey, can I build a chamber of reflections? You know, it's like, you know, like, you still have a skull, you still have it right here. It's like, can I build a chamber of reflections? And then it's like, no, it's like the Grand Lodge says that's a big no, you cannot do that. It's like, oh, okay. It's like, I'll pay for it. It's like, no. It's like, he's just not allowed. It's like, all right.
There's some issues with masonry that I mean, people sort of know my story, but my story's recently evolved and I haven't talked about it on the podcast. So a friend got me in touch, a student who's also a fellow musician. I wish I could say more, but I don't really have permission. Anyway, pretty well known for Canada musician. You might have heard of him, and good band. And he's part of he joined an esoteric Masonic lodge in town here that's on the more esoteric side, that cares about the work and all of that. And the lodge I did my EA degree, my first degree through, they lied to me about a few things, and it was created a bad experience at that initiation. So I never went back. So I tried to join this one. They said I could just join and finish through this other one. Grant, but they wrote to the secretary, whoever, said no, he has to go back to the one where he had a bad experience. I'm like, oh, I don't want to do that. And you know, I've been talking about with some of the guys, because I've gone out for dinner, and then I went out, met another one, and they're great guys. I want to join this lodge, but I might have to finish the Blue Lodge at the other one, at the original one, which has changed obviously since I was first initiated in 2004. So it's a different group of people. A lot of the people there are mathematically are probably dead by now. And so, but the problem was they're probably still the same. Like, I don't want to sit around toasting the queen, you know. Yeah. I don't want to take vows on a British flag. I'm like, you know, and when my friends heard that that happened to me, they're like, they should have, they, I was, my friends told me, well, Frater Yeshi, who's been an old friend of mine for a long time, Thuban Temple in Victoria and his order, he said they should have directed you to an Irish craft lodge. And I was like, motherfucker, there's such thing as Irish craft lodge? He's like, yeah. And it was like, yeah, these, and because the lodge that did bring me in, they knew it was all, like, they knew the Irish connection. They were at my house. They saw me, heard me play Irish bagpipes and sing in Irish, you know. They knew I was, like, you know, I was kind of a Irish Republican type, you know, politically. I was, you know. Yeah, so yeah, that's unfortunate. I don't know what I'm going to do. I might just bite the bullet and finish the degrees at this other lodge so I can then join this other one and then demit. Who knows? The administrative bureaucratic side of these orders has never appealed to me. I did a solid year as cancellarius, and that was really an awesome experience, especially because I think I was 20 when I was cancellarius for a year. You know, you have to learn databases, you learn all these life skills, actually, right? Like, right. A year of cancellarius for a temple that had over 100 members was really valuable job training and life skills for me that served, paid dividends in the years to come. There's a lot of really cool things that you learned from this.
100, remember, let's back up. Your GD Lodge had 100 members?
Over. Yeah.
Oh, wow. That's crazy.
Yeah, we worked our butts off, man. 24-7.
That's exhausting, for sure.
Yeah, I mean, not when I joined. When I joined in 96, I think there was like 30 something in 96 when I joined. And then, yeah.
That is crazy.
Yeah, it was good. It was good. It was a very good thing. Well, we were open 24-7. Like, it was available 24-7. People were doing ritual work in the temples, multiple temples, 24-7. A lot of the time. We had classes every single night of the week, and events all day Saturday and Sunday usually. So it was very, very busy.
Did you get paid? You should have gotten paid. That sounds like a full-time job right there.
No, more than that. Yeah, a lot of people think that we had a sweet deal because we would get to, like, a few of us would have lived in the temple house a place for free or something. No, if you lived there, you paid a lot of rent, for the time. Paid more than if I had, like, you know, lived somewhere else or at home during college with, like, most kids. But no, I decided to live in the temple and pay $400 rent a month when the average rent for a one bedroom was for just a bedroom in a house back then was $275 back in, like, the year 99 2000. The place, we didn't charge much dues. We charged hardly anything. So the place was constantly going into debt, and, you know, I'd have to use student loans to help pay for candles and incense, and the hydro bill, like, was $1,500 a month, you know, electric bills, all this stuff. And we didn't charge people enough. When Martin became in charge, he started trying to charge people more. And then I kept doing the same thing. And eventually we had a revolt, and, you know, I couldn't understand why people wouldn't want titles, but not want to pay $40 a month to cover the costs. Like, it's like, you want to be called honored. You want everyone who talks to you here to call you honored, blah, blah, blah. And you won't pay $40 because you think that you shouldn't have to because you're honored. Like, this was the thinking of some of the people I had to deal with. And, you know, had I just expelled them all, like I was ordered to, I was told to expel them by the inner order. Like, the people above me would just be like, get rid of them. Just get rid of them. People who want titles, but don't want to even spend $40 a month on dues. Like, they're done. They're done. They've had their experience. They've gone through Philosophus, gone through Portal, and now they want honor and respect without having to do anything. And don't even want to do ritual work anymore. Get rid of them. But I was such a nice kid, man. I was like, no, let them hang around. Maybe they'll figure it out. It's like, no, they're done. And now I know that, but I was soft.
God bless you for all the work that you
did. I was too soft to be a 22-year-old imperator of a temple of over 100 people.
Imperator. That's cool.
Like, I was so busy, I wasn't even meeting the new neophytes who were coming in. And the whole time I was in seminary too, like doing my master's of divinity. So I was had a full academic schedule. And then in every, it was awesome. It was great. Time of my life. I didn't sleep much, but hey, that's what youth is for. Yeah. It was amazing. Well, you learn so much being in groups. That's the thing. You really learn so much. How was the testing it with Chris Monastra's, or was it rigorous testing?
It was just based off of the Black Golden Dawn book, just kind of like those are the knowledge vectors. But I think that, I don't know, it's just kind of like, I'm big into Gnosticism. There's one phrase that Jesus says, it's like, it's kind of like, whatever you bring with you is what you take with you. So it's like the Golden Dawn teaches you some stuff, but if you don't know how to combine it or how to make it useful, it's like, you're just going to memorize a bunch of useless information, you know? So you kind of have to like, make it become alive. Otherwise, it's just a bunch of useless information. Like, and then some people, like even you just mentioned, or Mathers, you know, also mentioned, is like people get, you know, past the portal and they have absolutely, they have no idea what the walls in the vault mean, or what the colors are supposed to mean, certain things, or what is the placing of the symbols supposed to represent. I think Mathers got really pissed off when he's adepts, unquote adepts, were not able to explain that to him. And so, yeah, it's kind of like, you know, what you bring with you is what you take with you, for sure.
Beautiful. Beautifully said. Any other fun memories or anecdotes from your Golden Dawn days you want to share with listeners?
Absolutely. There's a lot of stuff going on. That every GD temple, I'm pretty sure, has their drama in one form or another. But I don't know. I was there for 5 years, so I got to learn a lot. What else? There was some drama. There's always this. Some people move, they try to form lodges here and there. Minister giving their blessing. I don't know. I think one of the great things that I learned about the GD temple is like I was ordered to arrange the furniture for the grades. And that is like such a great learning experience, because once you have to do that, and we used to meet every weekend, every Saturday. And when you do that every weekend, it just gets ingrained in your head. And so the placing of the furniture starts to become alive. So it's like, oh, so this is what that means. And this is what that means. And this is what that path means. And this is where we're going to use this. And so becoming kind of like the prop master, slash kind of stage hand, it really becomes a useful skill in the Golden Dawn, aside from the, and also it makes the whole ceremony more alive for you, because you kind of like get a warm up of what is the ceremony supposed to mean. Because sometimes when you are like the person going through the grade, you are just like, and this is something that I like, guess we didn't have, maybe some temples do, but I don't, or at least we didn't. A kind of an introduction of the symbols. What is the symbol supposed to mean? What is this path is supposed to mean? I mean, it's like have enough knowledge for you to be able to digest the bombardment of like ritual work that you're going to get blasted with. And so if you're able to, on top of your knowledge lecture, have an understanding of what the heck is going to happen to you, or what are the symbols are supposed to mean. And that is not breaking any of the vows, you know, it's like some of the symbols are pretty straightforward. And there's a little bit of that, like you learn your Hebrew, and then, you know, you go to the, let's say, practicus, and it's like, oh, that's kind of like what that means, or that's how it corresponds. But sometimes the grade just goes so fast that it's like, it just, all that knowledge just flashes before your eyes, and you have to like stop and realize, what the heck am I doing? What the heck did I just go through? And so arranging the furniture certainly gave me the perspective of the new candidates in a more richer form, which I think it was pretty cool. That's an experience that very few of us in the Monastery Temple had, because not a lot of us took the time to just arrange the furniture and arrange the props and try to analyze that. And unfortunately, also, I came into the GD with a Kabbalistic background because of Holler, and also an alchemical background because of Holler. And so the colors meant something to me, where it may have not meant something to somebody else. Or the Kabbalah, all of a sudden, I was like kind of double guessing. It's like, that's not what that means. You know, it's like, this means something else. So my Kabbalah, when I came into the GD, was a lot more Jewish as opposed to like just from the black book. And so when I was able to combine the Jewish Kabbalah, it was like, so if I do this, then it combines that. But of course, I kept my mouth shut. I just wanted to learn what they had to say, as opposed to like me telling them, it's like, well, you may be wrong, you know? But
yeah, I had ideas I had ideas like ego was in Yesod, because that's what the Hasidic rabbi had taught me, right? And so there's different schools. Sometimes people don't realize that Kabbalah is just as very variable, variegated. What's the word? It's got as many different schools and traditions as most other things. And there's different views of that, right? So the Hasidic rabbi who taught me, he was ordained by, you know, Zalman Schachter Shlomi, and he was an American named Yonasan Gershom. And he wrote on Kabbalah and taught me a lot of Kabbalah. But at one of them in the Golden Dawn, I was like, oh, yeah, this is a completely different schema. Yeah. Like, you know, and now it's like, well, yeah, I can see how ego would be put in Tiferet and the Ruach and equated there. But, you know, something can be learned from seeing it the other way, is seeing the ego as in Yesod, or the be equated with the Nefesh. But at the same time, then you have the problem of what the fuck is the ego anyway, because it's seen differently depending on what school of psychology you're in. So all of a sudden, like all of that whole project of making things line up and saying this goes there, is really only a very limited use. Or perhaps it's what we used to call the lesser mysteries, just getting a basic sense of the map before you go beyond it to discover what the terrain actually is.
Yeah, I don't know. I will put the ego everywhere. It's necessary. And it's necessary. It's a necessary curse, and it's necessary self-preservation everywhere.
Yeah.
It's like, if you try to understand the characteristics as they are somehow described in the Golden Dawn, you need the ego everywhere. But you also try to want to crush it everywhere. So you just kind of, you have to keep a balance of it, and kind of like, I guess, keep it in the middle of the pillar. And so not go from one way to the other, but of course you're going to need it to defend yourself in one perspective, and you need to crush it so you're going to be able to learn in another perspective. And so I wouldn't put it anywhere. I would put it everywhere for sure. At least that's the way I see it.
Yeah, no, that's exactly what I think, you know. Definitely I you got to find your I, the self, on the tree everywhere, just like, you know, looking at the significance of what, look at the meanings that are derived from every letter in every, yeah, in every path. Like, you know, there's different, yeah, it's just, it's good to look at the different models of understanding, I think. So do you have a favorite elemental initiation in the Golden Dawn?
Circle zero. Yeah. That's so, so beautiful.
Of the elemental ones, do you have a favorite?
Oh, you mean like from Salado all the way to Philosophers?
Yeah.
Salado, because not necessarily because of what happened to me in Salado, but what happened to me afterwards in Salado. It's like, that was like one of the visions I had of when I came home. It was like, what the heck? It's like, but then it just opened certainly gates in my head that it had never been opened before. And that is one of the most treasured visions that I ever had. Also one of the most terrifying ones. But yeah, not just not Salado for Salado, but Salado for what happened after Salado. Yeah.
Hmm.
If that makes any sense.
Yeah, I won't pry.
I kind of told you, it was like a vivid dream where I came right and went inside my head, and I saw like an ancient ceremony somewhere in Egypt or somewhere, and there was a hierophant type of dude that certainly had the power to bring you in and out of that dream. And, you know, he had other guides with him, and it was where your brothers, and, you know, and you realize that some of them are your familiars. And so it's kind of like what you bring with you is what you take with you. That's
yeah.
Like, it's like, that's, you know, it's not going to happen to everybody that's going to go through Salada. It's like, but if you bring something with you, something's going to get revealed, because you're poking it, and eventually it's going to open. And once it opens, you know, there's nothing you can do to get ready for it. You know, it's like you're going to pee your pants because of the power that, you know, some spirits or whatever it is, or something inside your head has.
Yeah.
Whichever way you want to look at it. Some people think that those type of visions are mental. It's like, it could be, but, you know, the language that was spoken, I never heard it before, and I went to try to find it, and I did find it, and I knew exactly what they were saying, and that's exactly what it was saying. And so my mind had never experienced that before, so I don't know where it came from. So I don't know if it's mental.
Came from the macrocosm, brother. Came from outside the sphere of sensation. You know, sometimes I wonder how much people have, like, you know, in the Golden Dawn, we had this understanding that there's the things that happen within your sphere as reflections of the macrocosm within the microcosm. And then there's the things that you experience from the pure macrocosm, which many would say is debatable. Some would say that's debatable if that can happen at all. But of course, I don't think prophecy would be possible, or many other magical phenomena would be possible, if there wasn't that penetration of the veil between the micro and the macro, so that you could actually receive, you know, true intimations from, you know, reality beyond your own subjective sphere of sensation. But I often wonder how much people are getting lost in their own spheres of sensation these days, just playing fantasy games in their own minds, and not being willing to realize that there's an amount of work that has to go in for you to penetrate that veil and receive actual data and information and pure intelligences from beyond your own you know, self-reflection.
Your own ego. Yeah. Yeah, we just have to let go. If you're not willing to let go, you will never be able to find yourself. Yeah. It's kind of like, I love that scene from Fight Club with the lime, you know, it's like, it's chewing up its hand. It's like, going back to my safe place. No! You know, and like, this is the best experience of your life, and you're missing it. It's like, but it hurts. It's supposed to hurt, you dummy. And that's when Tyler just leaves, you know, the familiar all of a sudden takes off. You know, it's like, now you're on your own. You're in control. It's, you know, you're in control now. And so that's kind of familiar's work, you know, it's like they push you through heck so that you're able to evolve, you know. And so otherwise, if you keep in your own little comfort zone and your own, it's like, this is what I feel safe with, this is what I have always known, it's like, you're never going to progress. You're always going to be in that little circle of like, this is what's comfortable, this is what's pretty, you know, this is what, you know, what enlightenment, in quotes, is, you know. It's like, you know, as long as you feel happy, it's like, no, it's like, certainly spiritual progression happens through going through hell. You know, it's like, you have to die. Kind of like in Freemasonry, it's like, that's the point. It's like, you die so that you can be reborn. And something, a certain part of yourself just really just dies, you know, the dumb part of yourself just dies and something else is born, and you have to embrace it and engage it and rejoice in it and trying to make it familiar. And then until you get to the next step, it's like, okay, what's the next thing that is, what is the next shadow that I have to confront so that I can release it and battle it? And kind of like that angel, you know, that Jacob, you know, was fighting, and then he becomes Israel, you know, it's like, this is the familiar that I have to fight next so that I can find the next one. You know, it's like the story keeps repeating itself in so many different ways. But yeah. give me the blessing, angel, so I can become Israel.
So no starting a Golden Dawn temple in Salt Lake for you anytime soon, but maybe one day.
I don't know. People it's don't still, get it.
It's too much people work.
And also, it's like, I also try to like tell people, it's like, I don't really want to do this. I want you to do this. And this is, I'm just going to do like this part. I want you to do the rest. But then I don't know why. It's just, I just have a bad rep of like being lazy or something, or scaring people out that I want to ask them for something, or I don't know, it's want to date their girlfriends. I have no idea, bro. I have never asked anybody out that I, you know, that I knew out of somebody else. So all the people that I have asked out in my life have been complete strangers. So it's like, I don't know, sometimes people think that I'm going to take something from them. I have absolutely no interest in taking anything from anybody. I never asked anybody for nothing except for like work, you know. I work, I ask for my paycheck, you know, but that's about it. But in the GD is like our Chris Monestro always inculcated in us, like the very Rosicrucian mentality. Kind of like we do these ad gratia, and we do it for the benefit of humanity. It's like we don't do it to make money. We don't do it to like try to gain anything. And so we just do it because of the love for the tradition and for the doors that it can potentially open. But of course, if you tell people that this is not going to be easy, that this is going to be rough, the people are like, oh no, but I want the easy path. And so it's like, okay, go find your easy path. You know, go spin your cycles wherever the heck you want to spin them. And also, I scare people because I definitely have changed the Golden Dawn system. And so that's what a lot of my friends tell me, this is not the Golden Dawn system anymore. Because that Kabbalah, for example, that is in the black book, is like, I knew the story of how did it get in that black book. And I completely disagree with having to say Aleph is the ox. Like, I don't get it. And I got it, but then I thought it's like, it's BS. Like, it doesn't make any sense. So I substituted that Kabbalah for Carlos Suarez Kabbalah. And Carlos Suarez Kabbalah, once you start using it, it's like, holy crap, it like everything freaking works. And not only does it work, it starts to become useful, it starts to become dynamic. Then you potentially you can use it. Then I started using it in Abraham Abulafia's meditation. It's like, holy crap, it works here too. And so Carlos Suarez's Kabbalah that I learned from the Theosophist, it just became very useful for me throughout my whole life. And so, you know, I learned Aleph is Ox, Beth is House, and yeah, whatever you want me to learn, I'll learn it. I'll keep my mouth shut. But deep down, I knew that Aleph was not an ox. It was this very complicated permutation of these very complicated astrological, cosmological processes. And Beth was more of a terrestrial also processes, as explained by Carlos Suarez. And then his books are super complicated too, and he doesn't open up too much. So you have to get a little bit of Theosophist to try to understand what the heck is Carlos Suarez saying. And then, well, he had this other teacher, and then you have to ask this other teacher, well, he's dead. And so you have to ask the students, and well, this is what Carlos might have tried to say. And so kind of like what you bring with you is what you take with you. And so I have changed a lot of the GD system. Like I, for example, we have this conversation, I think you and I on text, is like, I don't like the Enochian system. It doesn't make any sense to me. To me, it's incomplete. And so I changed it for like Grimoric stuff. And so the Grimoric stuff comes from like, you know, kind of like Saint Cyprian stuff. And so it's like, well, it's no longer GD. It's like, well, it's not GD. Cool. It's like, it's all right. I don't have to call it GD. I don't have to teach it to anybody. It's like, let's do, you know, I just do my own thing, you know, and because I love to learn. And, you know, I just keep, you know, what a friend of mine called me when you are the voice in the wilderness, he called me. That's
beautiful.
Like, you don't want to teach anybody. You just keep all the stuff to you, and you don't give a crap as to like whether anybody cares. And you're the voice in the wilderness. It's like, am I? It's like, I don't even talk, bro. I am just I am just there, you know.
Yeah. So Carlos Suarez teaches, he doesn't see much point in having students learn the literal meanings of the letters, but focuses on the mystical understanding of them that he brings to it.
For sure.
Yeah. Yep.
In fact, I think Carlos Suarez was also a Sephardic Jew. And there's a lot of tradition. Carlos Suarez was a Frenchman, but obviously he has a Spanish name. And so, in fact, if you also kind of like poke around in like Martinez de Pasquale, and you read, what is that, the Regeneration of Beings, I think his book's called, it's just Gnostic stuff. You know, it's like I went to Spain and I was talking to somebody about the book, and it's like, oh no, there's this great mystery. It's like, dude, have you read the Secret Book of John? Have you read the Pistis Sophia? Have you read the Book of Jude? It's like all these Martinez de Pasquale is talking about is Gnosticism, but he's trying to make a compendium of it, and it's like it's so similar, and so it's like it's hard to detach one from the other. But of course, Martinez de Pasquale had no access to the Nag Hammadi library. And so he had to get it from somewhere. And it was probably kind of like the Renaissance books of Plato and Aristotle and Euclid. They came from, you know, like Andalusia, Al-Andalus, you know, kind of like from the Moors. You know, those books were there. And the same thing with the Sephardic Jews. You know, they still had books somewhere hoarded that they made use of. And I'm pretty sure Martinez de Pasquale or some of his relatives had some Gnostic gospels or copies of Gnostic gospels that somehow, you know, sounded a lot like the Nag Hammadi. In fact, I love when Justin Sledge, he says, like, Kabbalah sounds sometimes a lot like Gnosticism. It's like, well, I wonder why. It's like Martinez de Pasquale talks about Gnosticism, and then you have Moses de Moshe de Leon, you know, talking about Kabbalah, and they are from kind of like very similar regions. And the Sephardic Jews happened to travel a lot through Spain, so that, you know, either for teaching or for escaping or for business, and they travel a lot. And so I'm pretty sure Martinez de Pasquale was talking about Gnosticism. And Carlos Suarez is one of those guys that also has to have some type of knowledge that it just, if it works, is because he had to come from somewhere else. He cannot just come up with it on the fly, you know. It was like, it is so meaningful that it was a certain type of Kabbalah, I'm pretty sure, that was practiced somewhere in Sephardic Spain. And I don't know, for me, it works.
Great, yeah, very cool. Just thinking of how the Kabbalah, well, yeah. It's interesting, I think, that Moshe Adel has argued now, and is generally, people generally accept his argument, that it was proto-Kabbalah that influenced Gnosticism and not the other way around, as we long thought. Generally, people have thought it was Gnosticism that influenced early Jewish mysticism, but arguably not at this stage, it seems. And especially now, as we understand more from Honegraaff's work about the most likely distinct communities that practiced the Hermetica or Hermetism, and how that is separate again from the Gnostic patterns, the Gnostic groups and movements, and then separate again from the Neoplatonists or late Platonists, but yet these people all intermixed and all quite a large extent and had common sources. So it's fascinating as we it's so cool that as time goes on, we're actually getting a clearer understanding of so long ago, and not a more muddled view. Like, you'd think, like, if human beings weren't such interesting creatures, you'd think that we'd know these things less and less as time went on, but actually we're learning more and more about them. It's so cool to see how that influences occult practices and developments and the way things move forward. I mean, I love the fact that Kabbalah has sort of been ousted from a lot of magical practices, because I think it was inserted needlessly. You know, a lot of the schemas and the the ideas of Kabbalah were extracted and then the rest was rejected. We see this, of course, with the idea of the klipa or the klipot being sort of just extracted from the broader context of Jewish mysticism and religion and turned into a left-hand path realm of demons and evil. Turn into methods to become a living god rather than understanding them as the shells and the husks that are a part of the divinity and part of God's self or nature, as I like to think of it. You know, I have a very pantheistic view of reality. I think, you know, calling God nature, I think, is the best way to do it. Nature and spirit.
Well,
I'm a naturalist, let's say.
Good question. When I saw that there was a Justin's Ledge episode where he talked about with the last place that probably Moshe de Leon was at, and I had to go. I had to go not to find the scrolls that were supposedly found there, but I had to go meet the familiar. Because as I read the Zohar, because I also started reading the Zohar, also even prior to Stephen Haller, thanks to the Kabbalah Center, because Madonna made it famous. And so I started reading the Zohar back then, and I read the Zohar, and it just clicked in my head. They're not talking about what they're talking about. They're basically telling stories that the familiar is telling them. But there are stories within the stories, and this is how they're teaching. And there are other books that also kind of talk about like that. In fact, the whole Bible is like that. It's like, well, not the whole Bible, but a lot of the Bible, they tell stories that are not meant to tell you what they're really trying to tell you. They're trying to tell you something else. And there are multiple layers of what they're trying to tell you. But only the familiar will be able to tell you what the heck is he really trying to tell you, because he has to give you the key. And so when I read the Zohar, I was like, oh, this is more or less what they're talking about. And then I get lost. It's like, well, I don't know what it's talking about. But then also I start continue reading. It's like, oh, that's what it's talking about. And then I thought, it's like, there had to be a familiar. Moshe de Leon or his disciples had to be talking to a familiar. And he kind of does mention it, the Shekinah. He calls it the Shekinah. And so I went to Utrera, Spain, which is, kind of close to Seville. And I went in there and I started doing my meditation, my Bolafian stuff. And sure enough, you know, it's like, oh, curly crap, there she is. And she's gorgeous. it's just gorgeous, and I was able to tap into it. And she told me, it's like, you know, keep studying. It's like, well, I gotta go. It's like, well, bye. He's like, can you come with me? No, this is my place. I was like, oh man, I wish you could live here. I wish you could live here and sit here and just sit there and just meditate all day long, but I can't because I have to go back to dumb Utah I'm the wild voice in the wilderness. but it's a beautiful tradition. Kabbalah is such a gorgeous, beautiful tradition. Well, I don't know, I may be crazy. I'm maybe the one just seeing a Shekinah that never existed. I don't know. But I know for me it's real, you know. And I have nothing to gain. I'm not going to write a book. I'm just telling you a crazy story because, you know, you're my friend and, you know, I'm just telling you a crazy story, you know. I expect to be believed, not 0%. Do not believe me. You know, it's like, you know, I'm never going to write a book about it. It's like, I have nothing to gain from this.
Well, dude, the second that a lot of people start believing the stuff we're saying is probably when we'll start seeing, like, you know, witch hunts again.
Yeah, that's the crazy part about this is like, I forgot, I think Angela Puka was saying, is like, why is this stuff coming up now? And it's like, because even in Mexico there are still small towns where if you say stuff like this, you will get burned or you will get beaten to death because you're a witch, because you're manipulating people, because you're scaring people. You know, but now, fortunately, I think we live in a society where, like, so many people are coming up with their stories that they, like, for example, this woman, this Davila woman, you know, if this diablo woman was like also say is like, oh, I'm a bruja and this is what I have done in a little small town, she will probably get lynched, you know, to this day. But wow. Now, you know, it's like people are coming up with it, and there's it's a lot more socially acceptable. And so me talking about this, I don't think it's going to get me lynched because I don't affect anybody. You know, it's like they're probably going to think that I'm crazy, and that's awesome. Think that I'm crazy. You know, it's like,
yeah,
power to you. You know, just let me do my thing. I'm not breaking any laws. I am not affecting you. It's, you know, just, you know, peace and love, brother. You know, yeah.
It's a funny time to be alive and be able to talk about this stuff and practice and engage with other people without having the fear of too much. You know, you're definitely not going to be lynched, or, you know, people you generally don't even have the time to mock you too much, because it's like, why would they bother? You're just LARPing, right? So
yeah.
Sure. And plus, spirits don't exist. God doesn't exist. There's no such thing as anything. Nothing matters. This is the prevailing social culture is one that's so vapid and devoid of any value and meaning that they couldn't be bothered to, you know, trample on any of us doing spirit work or practicing ancient ways. You know, they're too busy lynching. Who do they lynch? They're lynching what's it called?
Kim Kardashian.
They're too busy lynching. Yeah, the people they want to lynch are who are the heretics today? The heretics today are
Justin Bieber. I don't know.
Transphobes. Transphobes are heretics. That's you get you lynched, right? white supremacists. You know, so those are the boogeymen.
Those are the boogeymen.
I don't say that to imply that there aren't white supremacists and transphobic, or, you know, people like that. There definitely are. But we're seeing them in places they aren't, right? You know, just like in the old days of the witches, like, you know, you want, people would get burned because, like, you'd want someone's house. So you accuse them of witchcraft and they get killed and you get their house, right? So yeah, that's the kind of witch hunts we see going on still today. It's like, you know, I don't like this person's success, so I'm going to call them a bigot, and hopefully they'll get canceled and have their bank accounts shut down, you know. Mm-hmm.
Yeah, and also there is also the, I don't know, I love reading Ted Kaczynski's manifesto. There's so much knowledge there. It's like crazy, like, knowledge. And I know it's kind of crazy because he was the Unabomber.
maybe I should. Yeah, people do say it is an interesting read.
I love it. I think he hits every nail on the head. There's one where he talks about spiritual and being spiritually anemic.
Yeah.
And nowadays that is so true. And there are so many people that want to follow a certain spiritual path. But of course, most people are lazy. And so they want to follow a spiritual path that is convenient to them, that accommodates to their own beliefs, that accommodates to their own perception of the world. And so they're somehow trying to fill that hole, the hunger for spiritualism, by trying to make up their own spiritualism, which of course most of the time is like, what the heck are you talking about? But it's me, like, it's just me, you know, like, oh, I'm going to freaking Utrera to go find a familiar. Actually, that is me trying to fill my hole of my whole anemic spiritualism, you know. But there are some people that, I don't know, I think it was a Foolish Fish that said, it's like, there was a guy that was trying to make me read his stuff on, like, where's Nyarlathotep, and some Lovecraft stuff, and some Kabbalah stuff, and some Grimoire stuff. It's like, and then I posted a comment saying, it's like, yeah, bro, it's so edgy when you're trying to half-ass, like, the work of other people and put it all together into, like, these dark whatever, like, Grimoire.
Dark fluff.
And then it's like, if that's your thing, that's power to you, bro. You know, power to you. But don't expect other people to subscribe to it, because, you know, there are, you know, older traditions, you know, established that have been followed by people like you and me. Like, we follow our own Kabbalah, or, you know, like, for example, my friend, you know, he does his he's a chaos magician and he works a lot with the gods from the Lovecraft mythos. And then it's like, that's his thing. That's awesome, bro. You know, go do what you do. There are people that do Goetia. That's awesome. You know, I just kind of just started a channel where I've been touching a lot about Mesoamerican magic. So that's another tradition that has not been touched. And I have been exposed to it all my life. And I feel it is my responsibility to share it, you know. And so I'm trying to somehow make episodes that are also having the benchmark of Justice Ledge or Puka or Foolish Fish or Alexander, you know. And so, like, try to make something of with an academic basis, not just talk out of your AA, you know, just kind of like have an academic basis, because there's so much research done on Mesoamerican magic, and there's so much research done on Mesoamerican archaeology and ways of life, medicine, architecture. There's so much research. Not a lot of it is in English, most of it's in Spanish. So I'm bringing it into the English language. For one, is because I've been studying it all my life, and second is because I have the sources to back it up. And so that's,
yeah, it's great. I just subscribed to it the other day. I look forward to digging into it. Do you mind if I just pause for 1 second?
Yeah, sure, no problem. Was that the intermission, the bathroom break? I don't know.
No, I just had to adjust some things.
No problem.
Yeah, no, it's so lucky to be interested in magic or to be practicing in this at this time. Like, this is the golden age, really. Probably it wasn't even. It's probably better than in some ways it was ever in history, because the ability to communicate so easily with people all around the world and all that information that's online. I mean, the problem now, like when you and I started in the 90s, it was very hard to get information.
Most of it was wrong too, so
like there was no internet, there was just whatever you could find at bookstores. And now the problem is a surplus of information. People don't, I think that's what's partly contributing to people's inability to actually learn things and do the work, is the fact that there's just so many different things. It feels like, well, how could I ever know it all? And you have to accept the fact that you can't, and therefore the only value in any of it is to learn some of it really well and take it really deeply. To otherwise it's not going to have much of an impact on you if it just stays on the surface. So, you know, I've been saying this ever since I started the podcast, there's a difference between knowledge and information. And if you're just looking for information, then you're wasting all of our time, you know, for sure. Like, that's one of the things I like about the Enochian system, actually, is that you have to work to turn, like, there, D didn't get to finish his grimoire. And even what he did finish of his grimoire, because had he had another 50 years left and things had gone differently, we'd probably have the Enochian grimoire from D, you know, and he probably would have, you know, we probably wouldn't have his other documents. We probably wouldn't have all this stuff the unfinished stuff and the communications and diary entries. But because we have only what was left and what wasn't burnt in the fire, then you have to put it together yourself. So you see, that's why I like it as an introductory grimoire. And I think that's why in the Golden Dawn, you learn it prior to working with other grimoires, right? In 5-6, you start learning Enochian very seriously. And true, you're learning the Golden Dawn Enochian. It's because they had to finish their version of it to fit into their system, but also because it was incomplete on its own to a large extent. Even deep purism, which a lot of us practice these days, is still as much a reconstruction as almost anything else. So the fact that you have to work with the source material and put it together, I think is a great way to you're necessarily becoming invested in the depth of understanding that it requires. And you, whereas with, like, you know, Key of Solomon stuff, like you have your Key of Solomon, I like Sibley's Clavis myself over the Mathers one, though the Mathers one's classic, but the Sibley Clavis by Hockley that came out from Hockley is great. And But it's all there. You don't have any of the notes of how it was formed, and it's a complete thing in itself. Each one is more or less as complete as they are. And then you work with it and you connect with those spirits more. But yeah, with Enochian and also with like Christian angel magic of the Shem HaMefresh, right? When Christians took the three names of three lettered names of God and put the angelic suffixes on the end, they created a new system of angel magic, but outside of, but without a grimoire to contain it all. There is no Shem grimoire. I mean, there's the new book coming out, which is very exciting, by the Chinese magician. I can't pronounce his or her name. And, you know, obviously, whoever they are probably needs to stay very quiet, especially if they're in China. I don't know. Or even if they're outside of China. We have a Chinese police station now here in Vancouver.
All right.
Yeah. Where they get to monitor their citizens and kidnap them if they want to or threaten them. Yeah.
You're crazy.
I know, right?
I went to Prague to dig up these stuff. And also when I was in my...
Let's talk about Prague.
Yeah, and like my monastic assigned us mentors. And the mentor that she assigned to me, I used to run laps around him. And then eventually she kind of got frustrated at me, but like me throwing crap at this guy. And she told me, like, you know what? Have this other guy, a guy that knows everything. And so one time he invited me to his house and I was browsing through his books. And he had Fear and Faithful, what happened between John Dee and the relationship with angels. What was that called? Through and Faithful. Faithful
relation, yeah.
Through and Faithful. And I was able to understand it a lot, not only because of the old English, but also because I can read Latin. And so I got so frustrated with it because all of a sudden they were jamming, you know? They were like, what's the story? The angels were telling all these cool stories. And also I was like, oh, we got interrupted because of this. It's like, oh, crap. It's kind of like reading Lovecraft too, you know? It's like, oh man, there's this really evil thing that is about to show up, but the story never ends, you know?
Yeah. And so
with True and Fable is the same story, you know? Like you get really invested on what's going on. And I used to write notes and I was like, there was a little divination thing where like you spin the things and then it's wrong. And I think just as much made one where like I forgot it was the Monas Hieroglyphica, where the kind of like a magic square, big gigantic magic square, is like the magic square is wrong. It has errors and you can tell because of the mathematical derivation of where other letters are supposed to land. And so that's why I never quite jived with the, you know, because it's not finished and it has errors and it's incomplete. It's just like, and I never found the familiarity with it or the passion enough for me to try to make it make sense. Because, and I kind of get it. It is like the familiar sometimes tell you part of the story. And even if they tell you the perfect story, you're going to write it wrong. And so I get it. You know, if they were in fact speaking with angels, chances are that, you know, they probably made mistakes while writing it, or they got distracted, or it's like kind of like with old prophets, you know, it's like Solomon is jiving, you know, he has a relationship with God. I was like, oh, there's a really cute girl, you know, like that's washing herself. I want to go there and, you know, break the law, break the commandments of God, you know, and do my own thing. So even the prophets made mistakes, you know, but I never found the passion, or at least I did find it, but then I kind of lost it, to try to make Enochian make sense the way it's supposed to make sense. Because not only do you have to study Enochian, you have to correct the Enochian. And then you have to kind of finish what was never finished. And then you kind of like have to make up your own mind as to how do you want to finish it. And then it's not really Enochian. It's kind of like Enochian and a little bit of you. And so I never really quite jived, or at least I fell out of love with Enochian. I don't know if that makes any sense.
Yeah. Yeah. I think that happens to a lot of people. It certainly sort of happened to me at the end of my Golden Dawn time. And then I sort of, the first time I went to Prague in 2007 was, I guess, four years after closing Temple Tehuti and having, you know, done the bulk of the Golden Dawn Enochian curriculum. And it was sort of bittersweet being in Prague. But then the next time I went there in 2019, I had a really powerful experience doing work up in the tower. The tower trap door was open. They let me go up. And so I did a quick, you know, call of the 10th Aether, rent the veil. And the spirits were so present to me as soon as I reached out and asked, sort of like, you know, like sort of like Josephine McCarthy always says, you know, if you don't ask, you're not, the spirits aren't going to necessarily, you know, that's the first step, is reaching out to them. And I was surprised at how powerful, it just was a whole week of powerful communication and relationships between that me and the angels at that tower every single day and night. And it was like, okay, they told me there's a different way that I should just focus on working with them and not focus so much on the details of how the Golden Dawn or how any humans tinkered with who and what they are, is what they sort of said. And then later on, then when COVID started,
you're guilty too. Enochian anymore. Now it's like you with Enochian.
That's where it becomes what it is in the interaction. Like all of this is how magic works in general, I think, is, you know, without the human element, it's just nature and spirit. Then the human element comes to it, and that interaction of working with the spirits is where the magic comes from. So refocusing on the spirits themselves and on just the original, and, you know, focusing on the original ways that Dee and Kelly reached out to them, definitely transformed my appreciation of Enochian to what it is now. And now, of course, everyone knows how much I'm invested in trying to make it accessible to people who want to do it from a traditional point of view rather than the Golden Dawn. The Golden Dawn version way is there, and there's you got the Schulers. There's all these different versions with different names, and that's great. There's nothing wrong with that. Do what thou wilt, eh? That's what Crowley would have said if he was Canadian. Or do what thou wilt, eh? Shall be the whole of the law, hoser. but yeah, like, because you know, and this is something that I really value about, you know, what Jake Stratton Kent sort of left us with, was appreciation for the spirits themselves outside of systematizing them in on the tree of life, or outside of imposing their natures through talismanic images necessarily, or through hierarchies that may be somewhat artificial. You know, I mean, many of us, you know, the experience of using divine names or thwarting spirits and stuff, that's something you can test out magically, and you'll see its value. You'll see, if you don't think divine names matter and thwarting spirits or any of the, if you think none of that stuff matters, well, you can try that out and see how that works for you. But letting spirits be themselves and be who they are to you, because who spirits are to you is not necessarily how they're going to be to someone else, because you have your own sphere of sensation that's composed of your own astrological and spiritual, you know, underpinnings and interpretation. So it's like, it's spirits will appear differently to us and offer different things to us, right? Just because spirit can do something for you doesn't mean it will do the same thing for me, because I've got my own dharma, my own makeup, that you know, some things just aren't an option for everyone. I think that's my view of it, and again, I do believe the magic and also the metaphysics of it, the nature of reality, is derived from the interaction and that liminal space between the objective and the subjective.
Can I wrap about that a little bit,
please?
I was with Angela.
You want me to lay down a sick beat?
No. I was in the Angela Puka's the patron symposium, whatever she has.
Yeah, I look forward to joining that at some point.
Yeah, and she asked the question of, like, do you think that there is value to try to rationalize from a scientific, or at least this is what I think this is what she asked. I may be misquoting her, but she said, do you think there's value to rationalize scientifically magic? And then I told her that, or at least I mentioned, I shared with the group that you don't have to call it magic. And then when you're talking about spirits, that is such an arbitrary point of view. Because like you said, the spirit is going to act very differently to every different person. And that is probably has to do with the fact that some of those spirits are kind of a connection between your mind and whatever world they live in, or whatever realm or dimension, whatever it is that they live, and your mind. So whenever you try to interact with them, that is not a repeatable event, because the mind of the conjurer or the subject that is experiencing, it is very subjective. So it's not repeatable. You cannot do that. But there are other types of sciences that are totally repeatable. Like there are some chemical principles that are totally repeatable. There are there's a book that I love about, what is it called? The planetary influences on herbs and plants or something. It talks about how plants, they grow in different ways by the phases of Venus, for example. And that is a total, very Paracelsian alchemical point of view of how looking at things. And now, for example, I have a couple of friends now that are getting very heavy into, what are they calling it? Guided self-healing something. Anyway, there are people with horrible PTSD that come from wars, their bodies die, they're missing a limb, and they have these horrible memories. And a lot of them have committed suicide because they're not able to live with these memories and with this regret. And they go and try ayahuasca, or they go and try a particular mushroom, and all of a sudden they no longer have that regret or that or that mem or they have the memory, but it's no longer killing them. And so that is also very magical. Or at least like I mentioned in my channel, that I have never not seen food magic not work ever. All the food magic that I have seen being done, it has always freaking worked to the way, to the letter it is supposed to work. If you want to make somebody dumb, they want that this particular plant, it will make them somebody dumb. If you want somebody not have this particular memory, it will not have that particular memory. If you want somebody not to, or at least a traumatic memory, but I mean, they'll remember the event, but they will not have the whole thing that is killing them. Or, you know, it's just there are particular drugs or particular foods in Mexico that will make you not have regret or not have pain anymore, or will make you just dumb or docile, or it will make you feel euphoric. It will make you think that you are the greatest thing on earth. And if done under a guided system, you will not become addicted to it. You know, it is not supposed to be an addict. It's not a purified drug like cocaine or heroin, where, you know, ayahuasca is not addictive. In fact, you know, you don't want to be puking for 2 hours or an hour, you know, it's like, if you do it, it's like, that's awesome. You know, you have the experience, it healed you. That's it. That's all I want to do it for, because it's like, I don't want to be puking for an hour. And the same thing with certain mushrooms, you know, it's like, it's going to scare the shit out of you, you know? And so, but it's going to give you the effect that you try to get. And so it's called now guided, and it's becoming a scientific thing now, where they're trying to create these retreats where they try to heal certain people. And that is total food, drug, magic. And once again, it works, because there are a lot of wishy-washy magic in our groups, where oh man, I'm going to summon some spirit without making a pact, and it's going to work. It's like, well, sometimes it works and sometimes it doesn't. And if it does work, it's like, what is it just, did it just happen because it was supposed to happen, or it just happened because of something else or whatever? But food magic is just like, I had never not seen it work. And there are now studies where these people are trying to create these retreats of therapy for these people, where it rarely not works. And if it doesn't work, then they try something else, and guess what? It works. And so you don't have to call it magic. because it's something else. Magic is such a huge umbrella term for so many different traditions, and some of them work, some of them don't, and some of them work, but they're not going to work the same for everybody else. At least that's my rap. That's it. Thank you for the beat.
Yeah. Well, we got the new center. I don't remember the name, but we got a new psychedelic research center here in Vancouver. It's just outside of town. That's set up and run by Dennis McKenna. Because he's a UBC alum and professor like me. Well, alum, not, I'm not a professor, of course, obviously, but, yeah, we're both, you know, part connected to the UBC, and what he's set up is really exciting, but I'm afraid that I hope it's going to continue, 'cause he's so old, he's not going to be around forever. Right. And, yeah, we have a lot of that sort of stuff here. Well, British Columbia, where I live, as of my birthday, January 31st, decriminalized for 3 years all drugs as an experiment. So everything's legal here now. Every drug.
Nice.
Yeah.
Nice. But it's not the drugs. That's another misconception.
Well, it's here's like, the point. It means that like things like DMT and mushrooms and ayahuasca, you can do that without risk now. So that's
good. Yeah, that's certainly a good thing. But I think there's a lot of misconception, which also comes from like Mesoamerican cultural magic about drugs. That, for example, I had an uncle. He went to work with a shaman down at Real de Catorce in kind of like northern Mexico. And in Real de Catorce, peyote grows a lot. And so he went with the shaman and and then the shaman has to point out which peyote is going to work and which one is not going to work. And which one is the one that was going to work to the level that you're supposed to take it. So he went up there with the shaman and there were these other four guys with him. And then the shaman, you know, kind of pointed out, you need to pick up that peyote. And then my uncle is like, okay, so I'm just going to pick it up. No, you idiot. You cannot just pick it up. And he's like, what do you mean? You have to ask it if it can be picked up. And I was like, what? It's just a plant. You have to ask it if it wants to be picked up. Okay. So can I pick you up? He felt like the plant said yes. It's like, okay. The shaman said, okay, cool. So take it with you. This is how we're going to cook it. And this is how we're going to do it. And he just lays there in the middle of the desert. And he says that he all of a sudden, like, he opened his eyes and he was looking down at his body. And he was like scared, you know, senseless. And he's like, oh, crap, what the heck is going on? And he's like going up. And the other four guys are with them, and he sees them, but they don't look like their bodies. They look like something else. And so they're going up there, and then it's like the other guys is like, yeah, man, let's go up there. We're building this like gigantic castle. It's going to be awesome. He's like, no, I want to go back. And then the shaman is up there without the use of peyote. And then he tells them, do not go back to your body. Go up there. Once you get up there, I'll bring you back. I know you're scared, but I'll bring you back. He's like, no, I have to go back. And it's like, I don't want to leave my body. I don't want to die. You're not going to die. Just like chill. Just relax. Get up there and I'll bring you back. And then he says, no, I have to leave. And then he just got back into his body, like started trying to like move his fingers. And then he started slapping himself and then get his hand close to the fire and feel the fire because he was not able to feel anything. And so then the shaman said, it's like, you know, it's like, don't ever come back here again, because now you're all traumatized. And I don't want to have that energy in my place again. And then he said, it's like, you have to understand that you did not just take a drug. You asked the peyote for permission to pluck it. So now you enter into communion with that peyote. He's like, what do you mean? It's just a plant. No, it's not just a plant. The plant has a spirit. And you enter into a covenant with that spirit. And that is why I was able to help you to do the things that you're able to do. Like the way you're talking to me, I have a spirit. You came to an agreement with me for me to teach you something. But now I want to break that covenant with you because you did not do the things that I was supposed to tell you that you were not doing the things that I told you to do. And then now you have all this trauma and you're going to deal with that for years in your life. It's like, well, can you help me out? No. Because you're not doing the things that I told you. And then it's like, he says, peyote is the same way. It's going to teach you things. Plants, it's just going to teach you. So it's not just a drug. I think for this type of therapy, for it to be like successful, it needs to be understood from a different from the real shamanistic perspective, not from a like, oh dude, let's just get high and let's see what happens. Sometimes it works, but sometimes it doesn't. And if it does work, sometimes it's not gonna work forever. And sometimes it's gonna work counterintuitively. It was like, what is that word, counterintuitively? If that is a word. You know, it's like it's not gonna work for the purpose that you intended it's gonna work, because there is like these people that have been doing it for like freaking centuries, if not millennia. You know, that have been practicing with these type of plants, and they're able to make it do the things that they're supposed to do. And they have, you know, centuries of experience. And now we're entering into an age where like people are, they think that it works. But if we come into this type of tradition thinking that it just works like penicillin is supposed to work or Tylenol, I think we're going to come in with a new set of problems. At least that is my perspective. That's my take on it.
Yeah, that would be a set of problems I don't want to see. I don't want to know. Even if they occur, don't tell me what they are. I don't want to see a world in which, you know, entheogens and plant medicine are stripped of their set and setting and try to turn into some sort of Pfizer product. You know, like heaven forbid those fucking big pharma, like that is big pharma is one of the biggest problems in our world today, isn't it?
I agree. Yeah, the price gouging, the
crazy
taking out, yeah,
like I find it amazing how few people seem to realize that, or you know, how many people seem to not realize that, you know, like we're talking about, like so many people talk about just improve, you know, the ways in which we need to improve ourselves in the world. And you hear so few of them talking about making insulin affordable or, you know, all of that stuff. It's just a nightmare. It's a nightmare. Like, sorry, the amount of money we spend up here on insulin. And so, you know, like is crazy. And I know you guys spend even more. And it's like this essential drug that costs nothing. It's just.
Yeah, I heard HERMETIC is pretty cheap.
I hear a lot of stuff's cheap in Mexico, except a speeding ticket. They'll take everything you got on you, right?
Sometimes, yeah. it's true. But you're right. I don't know. I think that a lot of that stuff came from Maimonides. I've been trying to ask Beg Sledge to make an episode on medicine, because he says he doesn't know that much about his medicine.
Maimonides and medicine?
Yeah, he was a doctor. Maimonides, his primary job in his whole life was being a doctor. And so the story goes that there were like hundreds of people sometimes lined up outside of like wherever he practiced. And of course, he did not have the time to basically heal them all. And so I think he gave them like compounds of some sort. The books were actually incidentally published by BYU, believe it or not. and so the books of his some of his medical stuff were published by BYU. And so I have a couple of them. And so my mom just gave people, he's like, here, this is supposed to make you feel better. But like I just made an episode in my channel about Aztec medicine, and in for example, if you broke a bone in the Aztec times, they put a brace on you and they had a pulp of a particular root, and then they rubbed you with it. And in fact, to this day, there are still people in Mexico that still practice that. It's because they're called sobaderos. They either use alcohol or they use a particular pulp, and whenever you break a bone or dislocated something or you have a bruise, the sobadero kind of like just caresses your wound. And I think there was a study done by UC Santa Barbara where they tried to measure how long will it take for that particular fracture to be healed from el sobadero to go into the hospital. Well, the sobadero was faster. And then they couldn't really quite understand why. Because of course everything has to be like measurable, And it had to do with the fact that the spirit of the person that was rubbing the particular person was able to pass some of their health to the other person. At least that's the way I see it. And then it's like, it's also like you, it's like massages, you know, it's like when, you know, it's like I play a lot of pickleball. And so sometimes I pull a muscle or something, and I keep rubbing it, it heals faster than if I just leave it alone. Yeah. And I don't know what is a scientific explanation for that, but there is so much stuff about medicine that we still can learn from ancient traditions, you know, in my opinion.
Yeah, I mean, I thank God that's coming back, I guess, a bit, or never fully went away or something like that. It's still around. For example, like peyote's never been illegal in Canada. We've been able to get it, buy it over the counter my whole life. I never have.
Can you grow peyote up there though? It's too cold.
Well, that's why it's never been illegalized, because it's illegal in Mexico, it's illegal in America. So I think Canada just figured, look, if somehow you can get it from Mexico, out of Mexico, through America and into Canada, you get to keep it and you can sell it. So like, you can go, like my friend had a store that, you know, Chris Bennett had a store where you could buy a bag of Peruvian torch for one dose for $75. And you know, there's still a store in town that has it, 'cause you know, there's someone took his place, and you can buy the full, Peruvian torch, or you can buy the other one, the one that WB Yeats used to do with Maud Gonne. You can just buy the whole cactus and then prepare it yourself, or just buy a ziplop of the stuff and brew it up. I had some friends in a band once who we messaged them at night. We're like, what are you guys up to? They're like, we're riding the cactus. And we didn't hear from them for 2 days. And yeah, that was peyote, intense trip. Well, I would like to try it at some point.
Wait a minute, let's go back. Did you say William Butler Yeats did something? What did he do?
Yeah, him and Maud Gonne would you do peyote together?
Really?
Yeah. I know that. You know, probably shagging in the hotel and doing peyote. Yeah.
He seems too square for me for me to believe that he was doing that. That's cool.
It's in black and white. Yes. You want to get some real interesting information on Golden Dawn. Original order stuff, read the letters. It's always in the letters, right? It's one of the last letters in here too. She's like going on about how she would have been a good Nazi, and he's like clearly had enough of, he dipped his toes into fascist thinking like everyone did, and was like, no, not for me. But towards the end there, in their last letter, she's like doubling down on it a bit, you know, and he's like, ah. Then he died and she lived much longer, but
that was such a shame. Such a great guy. Just the fact that he kicked Crowley's ass, to me, that's like all-time hero for me.
I mean, he didn't, people out there for some reason believe he like threw Crowley down the stairs, and there's a meme going around, but that's not true, right? Like,
I don't know, that's what, no, I know.
He called the constable and they confirmed that Crowley didn't have rights to the building. And that was that, you know. Yeah, I'm pretty sure. I mean, there's people out there who would know better than us, that little event. But no one was really, I don't think anyone actually recorded the play-by-play. But yeah, I don't think Yeats, the meme is hilarious. You've seen it probably, right? Of Yeats kicking Crowley down the stairs. It's given me some t-shirt ideas for sure. But like, you know, I mean, yeah, Crowley went in and took a bunch of papers and tried to declare it his. And what's interesting about that story to me is how many other magicians have tried to emulate Crowley and do what Crowley did, even though he clearly failed magnificently in that attempt. But so many people model themselves on him and eschew Yeats or any of the, you know, and think, you know, Yeats is the one who is, I just think Yeats is the more estimable and sort of interesting character. Like, if you had to be like, do you want to be the guy who like tried to like steal someone's apartment and all their shit, or do you want to be the guy who like got that guy's ass kicked out for being a wanker? That's like, but I guess there's a lot of wannabe Crowleys in the world for some fucking reason. Who knows? I mean, if you're into, I can't imagine why. Why is Crowley so popular in your opinion?
in my opinion.
Yeah.
Because of the Sgt. Pepper's album.
Because of the Salt and Pepper?
Wait. The Sgt. Pepper's
Sergeant album. Pepper. Dude, Salt and Pepper should have done a song about Crowley.
No, I mean the Sgt. Pepper's album. You've seen that album, right?
Yeah.
How it has a little picture of Crowley in
That's
there.
That's not why Crowley's famous, why people want to be like Crowley. Though.
Well, I think that, I don't know, one time I was asking questions, going back to the Golden Dawn, because I was asking questions to my superiors. It's like, so where does our lineage come from? It's like, does it come from, and then one of them is like, well, it comes from Falcon. It's like, really? Because regardless, teacher was Crowley, you know, because he spent more time with Crowley. He was his freaking secretary.
Yeah, but and then, apparently Crowley, he never learned anything from Crowley. He, like, according to him, regarding himself, said he didn't get any teachings from Crowley. He just was just worked for him, which I always found hard to believe, especially given how much Thelema got made its way into Rigardi's interpretation of things.
This is probably kind of like a revelation. This kind of, I bumped into this information. My understanding, I may be completely wrong, the way in which Chris Monestra and Rigardi met was because Rigardi was looking for a therapist. And he was looking for a therapist because he has some really deep psychological trauma basically caused by Crowley, because of all the abuse that he had to put up with.
Wow.
So Monestra, I guess Patricia at this point, she just helped Rigardi with all this trauma. And I heard that there were like books of their sessions. Of course, she probably destroyed them after she died, or before she died, or after she retired, or shortly after she retired.
Who did?
But it would have been so awesome to read. What did Crowley do to Rigardi that he had to go through like 2 or 3 years of therapy to like to basically feel kind of sane again?
I mean, it might be, since we don't know, it might be more fun just to make it up right now. What do you think? What do you think it was? I don't know. Probably maybe just, oh, I don't know. What do you think?
I have no idea. I mean, I wish I could know the truth, because, like, I don't know. Crowley reminds me so much of my dad when he was drunk.
It was probably just Crowley's attitude, just his intensity as a person, because he was a very intense person, right?
He was just insane. he's like my dad, you know. He got into like a fight for no reason, which he ended up losing almost all of them. He was just violent and kind of depraved. It was like my dad drunk, that was the worst person. When my dad sober, he was the nicest person ever. And so kind of like Crowley reminds me so much of my dad drunk, you know, getting into stupid fights or like telling something to women that there's like women you're going to slap him for, and just being abusive and scary as heck, you know? And so Crowley always rubbed me into that type of personality. And I'm pretty sure he didn't do this only to like some people. I'm pretty sure he did it to a lot of people, and especially Rigardi, who worked so closely with him. And you may be right. He may, like, Rigardi may have never learned anything from Crowley, because he probably had nothing to really teach. I mean, he was just on his own little boat, you know, and making up his own stuff. And so kind of like the, what is that called? The Iowas or the
Iowas?
What was his familiar? Was his familiar, right?
That was his HGA, yeah.
Oh, yes, HGA, sorry. Sorry for the misnomer, whatever you want to call it. And so he, you know, kind of like made up his own stuff. And a lot of it was kind of like him on his own and with some of his background in the GD. And so he became famous, I think, because of pop culture, like Mr. Crowley, Black Sabbath, and Sgt. Pepper's album cover, and that perpetuated a culture of Crowleyanism. And then it was taken up by like the OTOs and, you know, other groups that he was involved with. But it certainly was, Crowley is undeniably an icon of 70s, 60s, maybe 80s pop culture for sure. I think that is why he's so big. That's my opinion.
Yeah, I guess that was probably the resurgence for sure. Yeah. But so Rigardi, of course, his lineage comes from the Golden Dawn Temple. He was initiated into Hermes Bristol.
Yep.
Yeah. So
yeah, but he was never an adept, so he couldn't pass on the charter, I guess should we call it. And in fact, I heard stories from Holler where Holler asked him, he's like, can you give me a charter? And then Rigardi says, like, I can't because there's no charter to give. And then he's like, I can help you as much as I can, but there's no charter to give. And then he also helped out another friend of mine, Pope Runyon. And
well, you know Poke as well, hey?
Yeah, I've been to his house many times. Yeah, and so Poke used to ask him questions. He's like, well, this is what I want to do. It's like, what will you call it? It's regarding, it's like, well, it's not really Golden Dawn, and it's not really OTO, so I don't know what you want to call it. And then Poke is like, what about OTA? Yeah, let's go with that. All right. So yeah. He took it on, and I think to this day, he's still doing his OTA thing, so that's great.
Yeah, he was just down the street from me when I was in California for 14 months before COVID, and I didn't realize he was so close to me in Sebastopol, I think it is, right? In California or wherever, somewhere like that. But yeah, I should have gotten in touch with him because I hadn't, I only knew him in 97 for a week when he was at one of our events, and that was really cool because, you know, I didn't know he was into ninjutsu at the time, but, you know, I would love to have gotten to spend some more time with him, but I don't know. Yeah, those guys. The ritual of the link, which Falcon used to pass on lineage, I guess, it wasn't really developed then. And it seems like it was developed out of some Rudolf Steiner practices by Falcon, or Falcon made it inspired by Steiner, by his interactions with Steiner, something like that. These are bits of the history that we'll never probably fully know. Because there's just, probably because of the burning of all the records by what's his name in Fadi Ra when he shut down the temple, Dadzelzin, I can't say his name, but the guy who closed down the Smaragdum Thalassus temple in New Zealand, they burned like 80% of the stuff. It's like, I've always had such a thing against people who burn that stuff or think, you know, so many people are proud of burning these things. It's like, it just always, to me, it seems so fucking selfish. Like we got ours and we don't want anyone else to get theirs. Like, you know, these mysteries were just for us. And you can all go to hell.
Now, there is a Rosicrucian legend, and I kind of believe it, that it says that once an order is brought from the ashes, its fire, you know, burns. But then that fire is supposed to last a certain period of time. But with that fire, more knowledge will be discovered. And as the knowledge is discovered, then that flame has to die to bring the birth of a new flame. And so the Golden Dawn, in my opinion, is good that it's dying. It's good that it just, because now if we were to create a new Golden Dawn, if we want to call it that, we have so much more information to make it better. Like the Kabbalah is way more accurate. The angelic stuff, holy boy, now we have so many more books that like Skinner, they have like uncovered so much cool stuff.
If
we were to recreate a Golden Dawn, we have so much more information to make it more accurate. So that legend is true. The flame that the Golden Dawn lit up, now you have all these people that have published all these books and that have found all these different sources. Now we have the tools to build something even better, in my opinion.
It's why I love doing what I'm teaching so much. Like I teach my weekly class, right? And I have my wealth of experience from the Golden Dawn tradition and other traditions, of course, like, you know, other traditions. But what I get to do now is, in my opinion, way better than in other, aside from the fact that you know, you're not doing the initiations and all, you have a full temple and all that, but the teaching process, the information we can work with is much better. And like, there's still some things that are hard to figure out. I was trying to do some research on the angel Zenael, which is the archangel for the path of Gimel. And I think search engines have changed. Like zero things came up online. Like Google search in DuckDuckGo doesn't work anymore. I tried to search an image from a famous tarot card, like a famous one, and I went through thousands of hits on the search engine. Every hit was just for something unrelated on social media or to buy some unrelated tarot deck on Amazon or some other place. Nothing to do with what I actually typed in, which is a very common image from a very popular deck. The image never was found. Google and DuckDuckGo couldn't find a popular comment. Now I know where to find that image, but I was curious what related things might come up to do, you know, where people commented on. No blogs came up, no personal websites, nothing. All just how to buy different fucking shit. And like, or someone's post with hashtag angel. So it's like, check out this Instagram person, hashtag angel. And of course you follow the link and it's like OnlyFans or some garbage like that. You're like, ah, get me offline now. But yeah, there's still some mysteries and things that are hard to find out there. But generally we have so much better knowledge and so much, yeah, we're spoiled with all the different things. Like, so I'm happy to say, like, I love the education I got in the Golden Dawn, as you did yours, and working with Chris must have been fun because she's a legend. But like what I teach now compared to what I was taught and versus what I was teaching 25 years ago, it's night and day. What I'm teaching now is 10 times better, if not 100 times better and more full than what we had access to then. It's just, there's no comparison. Yeah. There's no comparison. You could name any one of our, like, you could name Skinner, Stratton Kent, even Frater Acker, magicians who are seriously taking historical magic into their temples, working with it and coming up with amazing new insights and methodologies. It's just very exciting. And we got people like, you know, in the Golden Dawn world, we have, you know, a lot of good new stuff come out from Pat Zaleski and Nick Farrell and Tony Fuller. And maybe one day Cosmilos will drop a book on us or something. I don't know. He's a little mysterious, but he or she, whoever they are. But yeah, there's some, you know, the Golden Dawn's had a resurgence. Like, you know, when I joined the Temple Tahuti, I thought the Golden Dawn had died out ages ago. And I was just looking for a group of serious occultists to learn from, to seriously practice with. That's all I wanted. I didn't give a shit like what group or what order it really was. I certainly didn't think the Golden Dawn was anything special or even still alive. Now we know, like, there's lots of lineages and different trunks of the, you know, branches of the tree still alive from the original days. And it never really died out at all, unlike people thought. So, you know, it's going to keep growing in different forms. There's people like, you know, Sam Scarborough who are keeping it in its sort of pure state, you know, its very original state. And that's good. I'm really glad that's out there for people to do. It's like, do you want to go through the Golden Dawn with just the way they went through it then, with just the meditations and, you know, the LRP and the middle pillar and nothing else in the outer order? You can do that. That's fucking awesome. If you want to join a more modern group that does all kinds of stuff, including initiating people in through the grades in a random order, there's those groups out there. And you know, it might be the right group for some people. I've recommended people to some of those groups. I wouldn't recommend most people to some of those groups, but it's like, you know what, you're gonna have a good time with that group. Go check them out, and sure enough, they're having a blast, you know. So, you know, it's not my place to be dogmatic. I certainly have no desire to be. I'm very interested though in taking the impetus that exists within the Golden Dawn as far as like a structure of education. I think the way they created a structure for learning from the elements to the planets, to the zodiac, that can't be beat, I think, as far as a learning process is concerned.
I agree. I enjoyed my time there for sure.
Yeah.
I don't regret it. all the parties that I didn't go to, I don't regret.
I know, right? Yeah. I would sometimes, like, I would drive home from downtown back up the mountain after like an initiation or a ceremony on a Saturday, and it would be like, oh, it's only 12:30. I'll swing by my best friend's house who's having a party and get there, and I'd be buzzing off energy. And some of my friends, they would see it and they'd be like, they were drunk, right? Because there's high school, right? And they would like have to leave the room because they're like, I can't be around you after when you come back from that place when I'm drunk or stoned, because you're just too pure and it makes me feel bad about being me. You know, I would go there and get to interact with all the people and just then head home, and they'd be like, how could you miss the party? It's like, dude, you they could never understand what we were doing with our time. I was busy chanting in a black robe.
That's an interesting point. So what was the minimum age to belong to the GD in the Sink Temple? Was there a minimum age?
In what temple?
The Sink Temple, or at least the one that you were in?
Temple Tahuti. I mean, the order, I think, had required you to be 18 or 19 or something like that. But there was exceptions made. Nineveh Shadrach was let in at 16. Edward Reeb, Frater BT from the Esoteric Nerd Podcast, 16. And another Sore was allowed in at 16, who later dated him, Sore P. And she's pretty well known. And I reconnected with her recently. We had a nice Zoom video call and she's doing good. And then there was me, who was 15. But, you know, my mom had to come interview with Nineveh Shadrach and see the place and meet them all. Oh. and sign a waiver, because age 15 is below the age of consent in Canada. So if I didn't think about this at the time, but if someone had like put their hands on me, they'd have a legal issue, right? You know, so they didn't let me attend classes till I was 16, which is the age of consent here. And once I was 16, I was allowed to attend group classes. They were just trying to protect me from any adults that might want to mess with a 15-year-old boy, I guess. But again, I didn't realize that at the time. That didn't even occur to me at all. And it took, it was like a 6-7 month debate process down in LA about whether or not they'd even let me in. And there was adepts voting against it and voting for it. And they all eventually, over the next 7 years, turned around and were like, man, we're so glad we let you in, you're awesome. So it was great. It was, you know, cool. I knew where it was meant to be, I guess. To be fair, it's like, what's the chances, what are the odds that you let in a 15-year-old and that this law, you know, and that they will be serious about it and they will be doing it, you know, when they're 42?
True.
So like, you know, very, very small odds of that working out. So I'm glad they took a chance on me. I like to think that my own spirit guides and familiars and higher self were very actively, well, they led me there for a reason, right?
I am glad they accepted you as well.
Yeah. Otherwise, I probably would have had a very different life, just probably been a regular, average sort of geeky theater kid who I probably would have become one of those early Twitch streamers playing video games instead of someone who, you know, reads many languages, has had a adventurous, fantastic life, and still to this day can't play. I don't even have video games on. I don't even have computers new enough to function with video games. You know, I hope to be able to play some again sometime, but you know, it's just not a thing. My life took a very different course, and I'm really glad for that, because I'd probably be richer if I had, you know, just played video games and Dungeons and Dragons my whole life. Ironically, I always knew that if I just focused on that, I could be rich. And I always told my parents, I'm like, you know what? One day video gamers are just going to be fucking millionaires. And you don't even know what you're talking about. Because they'd be like, if you play those games, you're going to ruin your life. It's like, no, if you had done it seriously from the age we were involved. Those kids are now like big Twitch stars and they make crazy money, right?
Some of them, yeah.
Yeah. Anyway. Whereas you're not going to make $1 million in occultism. It's not even a chance, really. But video games? Yeah, you could just play video games 24/7 and anyway, it's so weird. Life's wacky, man. What else you want to talk about before we wrap up? What other topics can we do for, say, our last half hour here?
I don't know. You want to keep talking about it? I have to go to the bathroom first.
Whatever you want. We can call it here.
I can come back, but otherwise we have to, we need an intermission, bro.
All right, go pee.
Okay, I'll be back.
I'll do a musical interlude.
All right, very well.
Plus, the video, so far I've only been putting the videos, the full videos on Patreon now, because YouTube has new rules, and it really hit my account hard. Like, so the swearing, discussing certain medical procedures and illnesses. Now, like, get you really punished on YouTube, and they shadow ban you really fast. They throttle your account. So it's like my account got throttled super fast when those changes came in, because I have long form podcasts where I'm doing fake ads for adrenochrome as a fake intermission, right? Like, you've heard those. Have you heard any of those?
I have not, but I'm
okay, we'll do one here. Okay, we're going to take a quick commercial break. We would like to thank our sponsors. Adrenochrome. Get your 2-for-1 Adrenochrome today. Use code word Epstein at checkout. Back to the interview. All right, so we're back talking with Jorge Quinones, and thanks to our sponsors, of course. Yeah, so that sort of thing, you know, that's on tons of podcasts, stuff like that, goofy shit. It was lockdown, you know. It was lockdown. I wasn't allowed to do anything for almost 3 years. So we had some fun, but now with the algorithm changes, that's really punished me hard. So it is what it is, you know, whatever. I got unbanned on Facebook, so that's good. It was just an algorithmic thing, I think, that blocked me. They want a phone number. They won't let me sign into my account now unless I do get a text to my phone every single time I sign in, which is just fucking insane.
Yeah, that's crazy.
Yeah. So I missed all the stuff to do with Ed's memorial and funeral at Paul Edward Rana. And because I was locked out and I couldn't be a part of grieving for my friend, which sucked. Yeah, Zuckerberg can suck a big dick.
I feel so sad that Kent died, Rana died. That is so sad to me.
Ken?
Yeah, Kent.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, and we also in the Golden Dawn world lost Augustin Reyes, who was a really nice guy and really cool Golden Dawn adept with the Collegium Spiritus Sancti, I think that's the name of that order he was in, but originally was in ours just years after I left.
Yeah, that is so sad. It's so crazy, too. Especially Rana. I was like, oh my gosh. Are you serious? When I read that, I was like, are you serious?
Yeah, I couldn't. I was in shock.
And I reached out to a guy that you know, he knows him really well, and then he checked, and I was like, oh my gosh, this is so sad. At first, I thought it was like an April Fool's joke or something, but oh my gosh, that is just devastating. I mean, he's like such an awesome guy, you know, such an awesome guy, full of life. He was like, I don't know, at least for me, like, he made me afraid of being alive because how alive he just looked like he lived. You know, it's like,
live it's like life. If he's to the living, what am I doing?
Yeah, that's right. It's like, this is the type of guy, like, live life to the fullest. And then, like, talking to him is like, you know, that he valued his time very well. He was super nice, but he valued his time, and he will allow you to have the time that you needed, but nothing more, which is awesome, you know. And so I was shocked when I found out.
Yeah.
May he rest in rockin'. He liked the rockin'.
Yeah. He played an active role in my little hermetic mystery school. You know, and especially since now we're using Tom Berg's Meditations on the Tarot as a thematic guide through different ritual practices for the next 2 years. He was a big part of filling in the blanks for me, because I'm not a Martinist. So the bits of that book that are especially Martinist, he was helping me identify, because you know, he can say this is that and this is that, and not many people can, because you couldn't just be a Martinist and identify those things. You also need to be a Golden Dawn Adept to not get those, so you'd know where the differences lie and not confuse one with the other. And you have to know that book. You have to know Meditations on the Tarot. And he just was really, yeah, my students miss him. It was a big shock to all of us. And he did a great Shem HaMeferesh lecture for us a while back, and that's still available for people.
I think I saw it.
I might put it on YouTube for a while just so people can appreciate it and enjoy it. It's embedded into one of it's there for member. You can just join hermeticmysteryschool.com and access it in the Cyber Guild for free. It's just there for people who want it. But fuck, man, it's so heartbreaking, especially, you know, an accident, a stupid accident, and so young, man.
I don't even know how he died. I mean, I respect his privacy, so I'm not gonna pry.
Yeah, it was a firearm accident.
Oh,
yeah,
that really sucks.
Well, we can't end on this dour note.
Talk about aliens.
I did a whole podcast. Let's end with aliens. Fuck yeah. I did a whole podcast with Jeff already, and we honored Paul as best we can, and he's going to live in our memories forever. But he would want us to not end on sadness. So in Ed's memory, we'll end on aliens. What's going on with aliens? I mean, obviously, I'm not talking about the fucking balloons they're shooting down, but what's going on with aliens? Not this PSYOP.
The PSYOP thing? I think that
they're distracting us from the Ohio disaster and from other things, right? Like,
no, I don't
know. $500 million to the Ukraine, but not a penny for East Palestine.
Well, I don't read the type of alien information. I don't know. By profession, I'm an electrical engineer, and I studied like a little bit of like relativity and quantum mechanics.
Okay.
And so last year's Nobel Prize papers, I was like, what in the heck? It's like, these guys are talking about aliens. And it's like, these are scientific papers that are talking about multiple dimensions and how three-dimensional reality comes into being from a two-dimensional domain, I guess, shall we call it? I don't know what is that word that they use in the paper. But this is the way I look at aliens. I don't think that aliens live in other planets. That's the way, at least for me. It's like, because my dad got me into aliens since I was like really little. And so in Mexico, there used to be these magazines called Duda, and they talked about aliens. Like, there had to be a one or two articles in there about aliens. And I don't know where these guys got their information, but a lot of them came from Peru. So I heard like some really strange stories about aliens. And a lot of the perception that Americans have about aliens, it is like very primal. It's like the stories that come from Peru or they come from Mexico. Like, I don't know. It's like, I've seen lights that I cannot comprehend. Some of my relatives have videos of lights that hover and people that, well, little things that come out of those ships or whatever you call it. And they're like hopping around or like jumping around. And then it's like, how did my family, they're like, you know, they're like poor. And they never shared this stuff with anybody. But what will they gain from like wanting to make a video? Not that they can, because they have no expertise to make a video like this anyway. But you look at the video, I was like, what the heck? And then I've seen weird stuff. But the way Americans sometimes look at aliens is very like conspiracy theories. Instead, supposed to like try to understand it from a scientific point of view, which is the way I like to see it. And so, for example, I love where in high school, one of my chemistry teacher got me to read this book called Hyperspace by Michio Kaku. And in this book, he starts explaining how in super string theory, there are 11 dimensions. And so, okay, so if there are 11 dimensions, then is there space in those dimensions? Could it be possible that some type of intelligence lives in one of those dimensions? And so now that you read this Nobel Prize paper on how the third dimensional reality came to being from a two-dimensional dimension, then do you start thinking, it's like, is this some kind of like a program, that we are a program? And now, like, there are also scientific papers that says that we are a holographic program. And so if we are a holographic program in three dimension and kind of four dimension, where we made from, we had to be made from another dimension. It's kind of like programming, where you have to like programming arrays. Like you are in one array, and then that array gives birth to the other array, and then that array gives birth to another array. And so this reality can be just a program made by something else. And this is one of the things that it always eluded me to think that I am not my body. It's like when I wake up, I have to like come to the, like it takes me a second to realize, oh, is this guy again? You know, it's like I am, and then like something happens to my arm and it's like, oh my gosh, where did I get that bruise? It's like I am not my body, obviously. It's like I am something that lives inside my body. And so if we were created from another domain or dimension, whatever you want to call it, maybe the thing that's inside of me was originated from another dimension or another place. And it just happens to live inside my body. Does that make sense?
Yeah.
And so I think that the only people that have that type of control is entities or intelligences that live in other dimensions. So whenever I think about aliens, I don't think about beings from another planet that somehow evolved. I think about intelligences of beings in other dimensions that somehow control us. And then I read this book called Interview with an Alien, with supposedly this Irish lady that talked to the alien up in Area 51. Now the whole story, the whole book can be like completely fictional. But the postulates that it lays down are incredible. Like, for example, that this is a prison planet. That the reason why we're even here is because we were disobedient or we were rebellious in another realm, or we were captured in another battle. And therefore, they leave us in these bodies as a way to be imprisoned. And then that our bodies are supposed to last longer, but there's something that they, and then when we die, we lose our memories. I mean, the whole concept is like super crazy, but to me, it makes sense.
That's a very Gnostic idea, right?
Yes, that's also the other thing that that this woman alludes to, that and also I think, I don't know when was it published or whether actually the original manuscript is supposed to be as old as the book claims that it is. But if you can definitely marry the Gnostic concepts of the Nag Hammadi with the perception of this woman about, or at least the description of this woman about aliens, regardless of who wrote this book.
Yeah.
It just goes like hand in hand.
Yeah,
he's talking about there are different levels of intelligence, and these different levels of intelligence have these different types of powers, and sometimes they fight. You have the archons and the eons also. I mean, it can be viewed very Gnostic, but it's more viewed from a very high technological perspective. Sometimes I think we really prevent ourselves from even perceiving contemplating that type of thinking. Because I think that the Catholic Church and even Darwin have caused great harm to the human psyche overall. Like the fact that we think that we evolved into who we are, or supposedly we were bacteria, now we are these complex life forms, to me, mathematically, it doesn't make sense. Because most of life is chaotic. Everything dies. If you throw a rock on the water, there's chaos, and then just the waves dissipate. The concept of thermodynamics is chaos and everything loses heat. And so the fact that we can work in reverse, to me, is almost impossible. It's like, it's against the laws of thermodynamics. The fact that you can go from a bacteria or a mitochondria to a complex human life form, to me, doesn't make mathematical sense. I'm not saying that it's probabilistically impossible, because it is probabilistically possible, but it is just not likely. It is just that there's so much chaos in the universe that I think we were made, or at least our bodies were made for a particular purpose. It's like the distance, I mean, like the balance that we have on the earth to just be being alive is just miraculous. Like the levels of the water, the way water behaves, you know, atmospheric pressure, temperature, how our bodies are dependent on plants and, you know, amino acids. It's just like, it's just miraculous for the humans to exist. And so I would like to subscribe more to the idea that we were manufactured than to be evolved. And that's my perception of aliens, if that somehow makes sense.
So not interplanetary, but interdimensional.
For sure.
What do you think about the relationship between what we call spirits and aliens?
Spirits and aliens. I mean, now we're having, and now we're getting to a point where we're starting to understand that. Now that AI is starting to become so predominant, I think we're starting to understand what the heck does that mean. I mean, for example, in this book, the alien interview, the alien saying that, I mean, the woman is asking him, well, how long are you? And then the alien saying is like, well, my body is about, it's like, I don't forget what does it say, it's like 1.5 million years old. And then the woman is asking him, is like, how are you able to live that long? And then he says, they're like, well, there's this material that we get out of Proxima Centauri system, and they're able to manufacture the bodies. And in fact, that is why I'm here talking to you, because my body is not finished yet. Once my body is finished, I will be able to inhale, to basically live, go live in it. And so our bodies are supposed to last 1.5 million years. And then it's like, in fact, your body, she's the alien saying, is supposed to live 150 years based on the design. So basically saying is like, the people that imprisoned you designed your bodies, and we kind of know how long are they supposed to live based on that design. It's kind of like an engineer talking about another engineer. And so, I don't know. That's the way I look at aliens, to try to somehow make sense. And it also kind of makes sense, because I don't know if you heard some stories where some people have in fact tried to approach aliens, and the aliens either disappear or they just kind of like flash something so they like to keep people away. And also you have those like stories about, fighter airplanes trying to get close to aliens or trying to analyze them. And then once they try to close, the alien ships just kind of like hover away like really fast. So it is obvious that these aliens don't want to have anything to do with us, like nothing, zero. And then according to this book, The Alien Interview, sorry to keep quoting it, it says it's like, because if they were to talk to you, you will start to recover memories of who you were. And if you start to recover those memories, then therefore your prison can start to break down. Because once you die, you may be able to escape if you have some of the memories of who you were and what is your true nature. But if you only think that you're a body, once you die, you will just get reincarnated into another body, and you know, the prison will be perpetually long. But if you start to find out the truth about who you truly are, then you might be able to escape. And they don't like that. And I thought about that, and I thought, it's like, well, man, that kind of makes sense. Because they don't, like, these aliens or whatever they are, or, I mean, because it's hard to really negate the evidence that these things have been there. It's like, now there's so much video, there's so much, like, now things that it is, and even the CIA has come down with like now, like papers where they're saying it's like, this is like, they don't call it UFOs now. What do they call them?
They UAPs, call it something. Unidentified aerial phenomena.
Yeah, there you go. There's like, now there are these things and we don't know what they are. And so now even the CIA cannot really deny the fact that these things are somehow there. And so, but then you have to figure out what the heck are they?
Yeah.
You know? Well, at least that's the way I see
it. It's fascinating. I really hope we get some serious understanding. Some, just even the next step in our lifetimes would be nice. Like, I'm not hopeful for too much, but like, if we just one more step before, you know, because I think we will know a lot more, but not in our lives necessarily. Yeah. But if we just even knew a tiny bit more, it would be so cool. Because something's going on, something's violating the laws of physics, or suggesting that we don't fully understand physics. Of course, right? Like, yeah, it's exciting in that regard.
Have you ever seen that Bob Lazar interview with Joe Rogan?
Yeah.
Like, to me, that is like such a, like, that is one of like the best explanations of how their ships work.
Yeah.
I mean, it just makes, for me, complete sense. And now there's actually a Mexican guy proved that it works. There's a guy named Alcubierre who is, he came up with the physics for how to basically make holes within the space-time fabric. And then it was hard for him to like try to design a ship around this. Even Neil deGrasse says that it will work. But the physics don't make sense because you have to create like half like antimatter as an engine for these spaceships or ships or planes, whatever you want to call them. And then these other guys, I'll send you the link to this guy and to the guys who have proposed how to create the engines for these ships. But the physics now works that the ship basically does not propel with like exhaust.
Yeah.
It propels itself by making holes within the space-time fabric.
Yeah.
It's kind of like when you make a bubble inside of water. Like, if you make a bubble inside the water, of course, the whatever object is going to follow the path of least resistance. And as it does, it's going to go towards the air as opposed to the water, because there's less resistance in the bubble of air than there's resistance in the water. So when you break where you bend or make a hole in the fabric of space and time, you're basically creating a bubble. And if you're able to create that bubble perpetually through like a long tube, then you're able to just travel through the space, through that hole inside the space-time fabric. So you no longer need the exhaust. You're just letting the bubble take you.
Yeah.
And the physics is already there. So it's very strong. It's very exciting to me.
Yeah, that is very exciting. I was never an aliens person until the early COVID statements by the U.S. government that, you know, there's aliens or there's spaceships, you know, like, because I was always like, you know, I needed something confirmed before I ever invested too much time into looking into it. But once the government was like, yeah, this is not all us. I mean, maybe some of it's the government's, but not all of it. Certainly the government doesn't know how to break the laws of physics yet. Or if they did, they wouldn't be wasting Elon's time with his rocket thing.
Well, actually, there's an interview where Tyson deGrasse is telling Elon Musk that he should not invest his money on his rockets, that he should be investing his money onto this Alcubierre's physics. Because those rockets have a high probability that they may not land safely on Mars, and if they do land safely on Mars, that there is a very even less probability that they can come back. But these Alcubierre ships can appear and disappear whatever the heck they want. You know, it's like when they basically bend the space and time, it's just like, in fact, I think Alcubierre, his TED talk is called Going to Proxima Centauri in the Morning and Coming Back for Dinner.
Man, can you imagine actual space travel like that? Like if we had like that sort of Star Trek level space travel, man, that would be fucking so cool. Oh,
no, but it goes back to like the prison that we live in, because according to some of the physics, our bodies, the way they are, they cannot travel in those ships, because I guess there's a type of radiation that the ship builds up when it travels through these space-time bubbles, that it will destroy the body. And so the bodies cannot travel like that. So therefore, we will have to create a type of robot, like this alien was describing, a certain type of robot that has somehow our consciousness within these robots to be able to travel like that. And so our bodies are prisons. They're very delicate, flimsy prisons. And also, they don't live very long.
No, they don't. They don't even live 150 years, you know. And I personally blame that on Genesis 6:1-4, of course. If it hadn't been for those damn indiscretions, no. Do you think after we die is the beginning or the end?
After we die, it's a new cycle. It's a whole new cycle.
You think it's a new cycle of the same thing, or cycle of a different cycle somewhere else?
I don't know. Have you ever heard of the Institute of Noetic Science?
Yeah.
They have made them and another colleges have made some studies on reincarnation. And one thing that happens about reincarnation is that sometimes your reincarnated bodies, they have memories of previous lives that they have. Before, of course, they had absolutely no way of knowing that information that they had, these new people. But the information is always slightly wrong. The time is a little wrong, or certain facts are a little wrong. Most of it is accurate, but sometimes certain time is off or certain events are off. So I think that when we die, something very similar happens, in which we are basically jumped into a similar reality, but it's likely different, or in another time, or in another or in the past or in the future. I don't know how it works. The best theory to try to back that up, I don't know, it's probably the Bhagavad Gita. I don't know. You know, the Bhagavad Gita with the reincarnated whatever's based on the life that you lived. It kind of makes sense. It also goes back to that Jesus saying, he's like, what you bring with you is what you take with you, you know? So if you reincarnate or you stay up there with whatever it is that you build up in this life, is what you're going to live up there with, you know, or in the next life. So it's kind of like Bhagavad Gita kind of thing.
Yeah. I mean, that was my Bible growing up as a kid. That's what, you know, I grew up in the Eastern Rig Veda. I've still got the big copy of the Rig Veda my mom would read when we were little. And nice. Yeah, it was special. I didn't realize it at the time, but now looking back, it's like, that was pretty cool, you know, to grow up as in a Eastern yoga cult. You know, I mean, Maharishi's a character. He had the Rolls Royces, just like Osho or a lot of those other gurus, but he definitely had a presence, and there's nothing wrong with his system of meditation. I mean, it's essentially the basic form is essentially a variation on the cloud of unknowing, but I think mantra repetition meditation is probably universal in a lot of cultures, if not all of them. What's interesting from a magical point of view that I've thought recently that might be different from what people would expect is that I used to say, don't bother with transcendental meditation because you don't need to pay the $1,000-$2,000 to get the mantra. You could just use any word from the Bible or, you know, the cloud of unknowing style and repeat that and have the same experience. But as I've aged and matured as a magician over the last 20 years, it occurred to me, wait a second, what about the initiations I went through in 1988 and then in 1991? I had to go through the two initiations. If you come to it as an adult, you only go through one initiation. But, you know, led into a dark room alone as a kid at 7 and then at 10. And altar with all the gurus and the guru lineage and the incense and the whole thing. It's a full ceremony, and they invoke the these ancestors and these prophets and saints and these other spirits and gods to do things to you and to bless you with this mantra and to work upon you in a very similar way to like what we see in other magical initiations. I mean, in Masonry, there's no spirits being invoked to act upon the candidate, like, but in the Golden Dawn there is, and in a lot of other magical traditions, there's the initiations are very magical, with spirits being compelled or directed or requested to do things to the candidate from now on. And that is done in transcendental meditation. So you have these gurus, ascended masters, essentially, being invoked to take action upon your soul and upon your life as you use those mantras. So I was like, oh, it's actually a lot more sorcerous than I used to think, because that's significant, right? I mean, as a magician, I could never now deny the effectiveness. And it's sort of crazy, right? Anytime you ask spirits to constantly act upon someone, that's a thing. That's a very noticeable thing, in fact. Yeah, so that sets it apart from basic mantra meditation in a way, because that's a magical component. So I think, yeah, it's interesting to grow up that way with spirits being, you know, an ancestor. It's interesting. It's definitely interesting. I mean, I'm glad that I had a conversion experience. I'm glad that I converted to Christianity. I'm very happy in my faith as an Anglo-Catholic. That works for me, for who I am today. But, you know, I've never stopped meditating, that's for sure. And I never will. So if there's any chance that somehow that could, I guess, lead us to a better hereafter or a more interesting adventure in the next life. I don't know if I necessarily want to come back here. Every psychic my mom took me to as a kid always said I wasn't coming back, but you know, I don't know what that means. I'm not convinced that reincarnation is a real thing. I'm open to being wrong, but again, you know, I think here, the reason is because I think it is, if it's real, I do believe it's provable. I believe we will scientifically prove it if it's real. I believe that about reincarnation and a number of other things. Is there any spiritual practices that you believe can and will be proven scientifically that just haven't been yet?
No, because it goes back to like what I was saying, because they're mental. You cannot prove mental stuff because it is very subjective. And so you cannot just pinpoint subjective experiences, because they're arbitrary. Everybody has their own different experience, and so anything that is mental, you can, it's like, I don't know, like I read this book called the one with the slime, what's it called, Principles of Neural Science. And so where Schwartz is trying to map out mental processes inside this gigantic slime. And so Schwartz said, I was like, okay, so if it feels fear is gonna trigger in this part of the brain of the slime, and if, or this part of like the slime, whatever. Or if it senses fire, it's gonna sense here. And if it senses joy, it's gonna sense here. If it senses water, it's gonna sense here. Well, that works fine and dandy for a slime, because its neural networks are so visually there, but the brain were able to break up to a certain point, which that's why like he won, him and Kendall won a Nobel Prize. But the human brain is so complex, and it works different for different people because there are different neural patterns. And so based on our subjective experiences, we form neural patterns. And since we all have very different experiences, we all have different neural pathways. And so it's difficult to prove something mental since there are so many different neural pathways and networks. Or unless we're able to break it down to those basic parameters of like, okay, so if you have this neural pathways, then this particular experience is supposed to manifest itself in these neural pathways. And then if, you know, but then there are so many different neural path networks because we all have many different experiences. So I think it's very different. It's very difficult for me to prove anything mental, if that makes any sense.
Yeah, well, yeah, when I think about proving things, it's usually the mental things that are harder. I mean, reincarnation, I think, because it's got physical memory-based features. I think if it is a real thing, it will inevitably be proven. Like if people really are reincarnated from previous lives, eventually, like, you know, there's other explanations for where those memories could come from, but if it really is a thing, I think there will be data eventually to sort of prove it if it's real. But then there's other phenomenon like, you know, spirit evocation. There's a lot of Heptameron and Goetic magicians that say like John R. King, the is it John King? Yeah, you know, Mr. King in his Imperial Arts. He claims the Goetic spirits manifest fully visibly to him and would be seen if someone else were present, but he can't do the rituals unless with someone else present. So I don't know what to do with that. But like I've seen physical phenomenon in lots of ritual work and evocations, and you know, eventually someone might actually film some of it, you know, even it wouldn't take much. Like a sphere of light over the any sort of anything over the triangle would be sufficient for a lot of people. If I'm just You know, I'm sort of spitballing here. Just these are the fanciful things we play with at the end of a 3-hour discussion, of course, or late into the night. But you know, there's other things, you know, minor acts of clairvoyance, telekinesis, psychokinesis, all of these sort of things, you know. The lots of claims, but no proof. People listening to this, some of the people, of course, be like, oh, there is proof. You have to look at this thing. You have to look at this girl in India, or you have to look at this guy in India. Well, a lot of those are faked, and you can see the debunking videos about them. But some of those things are possible, perhaps. And I don't know. I'm just curious if there's any of them. We all have our sort of our pet theories about whatever sort of psychical phenomenon we think might be, we might find evidence for. And so I was curious if you had any of those, since you got such a broad base of experience.
Evidence, no.
No.
Everything's subjective,
Yeah.
and that is the
Could be that
beauty of
way.
it. Everything, that's the beauty of it. It's like Jesus sometimes. It's like if you read, like, I don't know, you're a Christian, so you'll probably understand this. It's like Jesus refutes everyone and everything. You know, it's like people are following him, and then he turns around. He's like, "Why are you following me?" I was like, "Because we believe you're the master." "No, you're not. You're following me because I've fed you. Get the heck away from me." Goes on and leaves. You know, the same thing with, like, I don't know, the woman at the well, the guy he cured from blindness. He's like, he does all these great things for everyone,
Or
and then he just disappears.
the
He
woman
disappears.
who healed herself by touching his robe. And one of my favorite, most interesting lines in the Bible is when he said, when he felt the power go out of him, you know, like she touched his robe and saw what she's like. She's a vampire. She like sucked the power out of him and healed herself. And she's like, how am I healed? And he's like, I didn't do it. But clearly she took his power, and it's her faith that healed him. Her faith healed her faith healed her, but yet she had to also touch his robe and the power went out of him. So there's a weird, it's like whoever wrote that passage, whoever just transcribed it down or wrote it down from the oral tradition or the wall painting or whatever, it's like they had a couple different stories, or they didn't know how to wrestle with it theologically or reckon it theologically, and so they're just like, this is what we got, this is what we heard, this is, you know, make what you will of it. It sort of speaks to different traditions at once, both the Goetic magical practices that were common at the time, as well as to perhaps a theological agenda of the gospel writers themselves. Who knows? But it's fascinating to me.
Yeah, and I also feel for them, because it's hard to describe those things.
It is.
And then you have to write it in a weird type of Greek, because you're not a native, you're not Plato, you know, you're not Aristotle, where you know have this gigantic like vocabulary, Greek vocabulary. So you try to have to somehow writing in the whatever Greek that was spoken in Jerusalem, you know, and so sometimes the descriptions are kind of weird and the language is kind of poor. And then again, it's like, how the heck are you going to describe this? It's like, there's nothing to compare to.
Yeah, well, they were all speaking Aramaic, but often writing in Greek, in Koine.
Yeah.
Yeah, very weird.
Yeah.
Indeed.
Yep.
We should probably leave it there, I guess. I think we've gone over 3 hours. This has been, like you said, we could go on forever. When you said we could go on forever, I was like, I don't know. Are we going to talk for 5 hours? Because we all know I've done 5-hour podcasts, right? Yeah, I'm sure you've listened to every minute of them. But they were always good. They usually start earlier in the evening. This was going to be a late one, and I was totally down for it. I'm here for it. And thanks to everyone for listening to my lovely guest here, Jorge Quinones. Quinones or Quinones?
It's
Quinones. Quinones. See, I got it. I got a new D&D player in my D&D group, and he's from Mexico, and him and his girlfriend came out to my little birthday at karaoke, and they're both really lovely. He's from Mexico, but he works here in marketing. I think he does marketing for like two other countries down there. Like, it's really weird. I'm like, what is going on? Why is someone from Mexico working in marketing to market to like Ecuador and Peru in Vancouver? I'll find out. I'll let you guys know next time when I find out more. But him and his girlfriend have very interesting jobs. And I'm like, I've never heard of Mexicans coming to Vancouver to work on marketing for non-Mexican South American countries. It's like, I was like, are you a spy? Are you, is he a spy? Who cares? We just want to roll D20, you know, sometimes. Do you have any hobbies that keep you sane?
Pickleball.
Pickleball,
yeah.
Pickleball. Right, you mentioned that before.
Yeah. I play pickleball.
Pickleball. Cool.
Pickleball is my thing. And of course, like any Mexican, I watch some soccer, you know.
Somehow we didn't get to talk too much about Joseph Smith and Solomonic magic and Mormonism. But I, like I said, I have those photos that Damien sent me. And I was going to have Dr. Cannon on to talk with me about them, though it's not, he doesn't know it inside and out. Maybe the three of us can just do a little review of those images. And talk a bit about that, do a special little video episode for YouTube where we go through Damien's pictures. Cause he's not, yeah, he said, go for it. And we can comment on them and discuss a little bit more about Joseph Smith's magical background. Dr. Cannon mentioned to me that there's people, serious scholars, who are actually on it. They're investigating that. There's good people on it. We don't need to worry about it, but I think it would still be fun to discuss it a little bit, especially since such lovely images were sent to me for this purpose by Monsieur Eccles. That would be fun, eh?
Yeah, for sure. There's an episode that talks about that in Cold,
yeah.
Mormon Stories podcast. They have an episode about that from a PhD.
Oh, yeah. You'll have to send me a link to that. I'll check that out. But yeah, let's try and do a little video thing on that.
There's not that much in it, to be honest. I mean, since we know, I think it could, a lot of the stuff came from Agrippa. But I forgot which book Joseph Smith had access to. But it was kind of a derivation from the 5 books of Agrippa. And so he owned, it is proven that either his dad or he had access to this book. And so these PhDs think that a lot of the stuff that he did was based on the practices from this book.
Yeah.
But they don't go into specifics as to what were the particulars of these practices, because they don't understand it from a magical perspective. They understand it from a literary perspective, but they don't know the magic enough to know, oh, this is this ritual and this is what it's supposed to be doing. And so, you know, people like us, we could be, we have access to like evidence of, or even your, it's not that hard to make conjectures on, okay, so if you look at the hat with the stone, which part of the ritual is he invoking? And, or if he's talking to angels, if we have a little bit more details as to like what was he doing prior to talking to these angels, are we doing an invocation? Are we doing an evocation? Who was talking for these angels? So yeah, there's definitely room for the perspective of practical, or at least people that are more familiar with the works of Agrippa, to contribute to the historical analysis of Joseph Smith using magic, for sure.
It's fascinating. Like, I've never had any connection with Mormonism whatsoever. So the fact that it interests me, I think, is a sign of how interesting it really is. It really is fascinating. So I think I showed you some of the images Damien sent me, but if not, I'll send you the images, because yeah, I'll put them on a slideshow, and maybe you, me, and Dr. Sam Cannon, who's also a Mason and GD guy, we can do a little, just share what you guys can share what you guys know, and I'll ask neonate questions that the average person might wonder, because I'm curious. I'd love to know more. I know you guys don't have all the answers, but it would be fun to hear about it from two Mormons with magical backgrounds and all of that. That would be super fun little video to make with you guys. So yeah. That'd be cool thing. Let's try and make that happen maybe by the end of the month.
Cool.
All right, yeah. Brother. Thanks. Do you want to shout out your channels, and whatever else you want people to know about?
Just my name, Jorge Quinones, Mesoamerica.
The YouTube channel is, I'll link it below. I'll link it, folks. Mesoamerica.
Mesoamerica. That's right.
Yeah. Yeah. Cool. Well, good luck and keep doing the good videos and all that. You know, I know how much work it takes.
For sure. Thanks.
So I also just noticed that your patch that looked like the arm and hammer logo doesn't say arm. It's the arm and hammer logo, but it says armed and hammered.
That's right.
Oh Lord, make me pure, but not yet.
That's right.
All right.
It was great. Great times, brother. Thank you very much. Have a great night.
Yeah. Good night, folks. Go join his YouTube channel, subscribe, do the thing with the other thing and the thing, and make a comment thing. And we'll see you next time.
Yeah. Have a great one.